When did slavery become a criminal offence in England?
It was not in the 1960s. I bet it was one of these odd little new Labour laws in about 1996, 7, 8.
What an odd law to outlaw slavery. His political correctness gone mad.
Odd in the sense that it's a bit late.
Yes, that's exactly right. It was 1807 when the slave trade was ended, and then finally in 1834, it was illegal anywhere in the British Empire to own a slave. It has never been illegal to have a slave in England until April 2010. I'm saying I could have had you as a slave legally.
You mean this series I'm finally free?
Yes!
But you know what? I mean, one of those slaves who just goes back to the master. I don't know what to do. I work for you anyway, please.
One thing is that there are now estimated to be 27 million people held in, essentially, in bondage, in slavery on this planet.
But the show
now,
will be over soon. More, you can go.
Yeah.
Right now?
More than there ever were in the days of cotton picking and so
27
on.
27
million?
27 million. In the world?
Yeah, that is the estimate. It's a pretty grim problem still, slavery. The point is, it was never illegal in England because it was never recognised as a state of being. There were laws against kidnapping and abduction and false imprisonment and sexual trafficking and all the other things that we might associate with slavery. But it was not illegal for one human to own another human, which it now is.
So this is a law that this isn't one of those laws where they thought, oh, that needs to clearing up, it's a loose end from history.
It kind of was. In 1967, there were a number of obsolete crimes that were taken care of. Barratry had been illegal right up to 1967, which is vexatious lawsuits.
Oh, okay.
Building of vexatious
lawsuits. Yeah, what they call a vexatious litigant, somebody just keeps
carrying. Dorothy Squires.
Yes.
Dorothy Squires, the singer Dorothy Squires, towards the end of her life when she did have a mania, but she was probably the last person to be done for vexatious litigant.
And if you kept prosecuting someone for it, you'd be prosecuting them.
Yourself?
Yeah, well, it's crazy. Anyway, there's scolding. Scolding was a crime in 1966, but not in 1967.
With hot water, you mean?
No, not scolding. Scolding. No. Scolding!
That was a crime.
You! What time of the night do you call this, Eddie Izzard?
12.
Yes.
12:30.
Well, they give you a good scolding.
And that was illegal?
That was illegal.
Illegal?
Yeah.
And now it's legal?
Eavesdropping was illegal. Challenging someone to a fight was also illegal until 1967.
What about going round and round and round about more than three times?
It certainly wouldn't have been a medieval law, would it?
Well, I don't know. And if you had a horse and cart, you had a couple of hours spare.
On a medieval roundabout,
On a medieval roundabout.
Yes. Anyway, there you are. Due to a quirk of English law, it only became a criminal offence to keep a slave in the year 2010. So you just...
What animal gets the lion's share of online viewing?
I don't know, but that horse looks like Donald Trump.
We had a cat who used to watch the telly. He watched a documentary about urban foxes. And he watched the whole programme with his paws up on the back of the chair looking at it like this. And about 6 months later, they repeated it.
Yeah.
And he watched it all again. And every time a fox went out of the side, he went like that.
Probably birds as well. Birds probably watch a lot of TV because they're in the room, aren't they?
What about people who hang their budgie by the window so it can see the other birds outside?
Yeah,
isn't that not the definition of evil?
Yeah. Anyway, none of this is what I wanted to talk about.
Is it lions?
Yes, no. surprising.
Blue whale.
Surprisingly, there are more dog videos on YouTube than there are cat videos. So people always talk about cat videos. 65.9 million dog videos versus 65.3 million cats. The dog's just got the edge there. Why do we think that might be?
Dogs are better than cats. Oh, that's the most controversial thing ever said in the studio.
Yeah. I'm with you, Carrie.
Thank you.
Yeah,
that is the Brexit of the pet world. Yeah. In England, people would care more about that than they did about Brexit. Yeah. If you start slagging off dogs or cats.
Yeah. Let's try it. People who like cats say cats. People who like dogs say dogs.
People who like Brexit say Brexit.
People who like people say people.
That's me.
Nothing.
Hardly anything. I have to say that Google Google tells a different story than YouTube. There are 2.2 billion pages about cats compared to 1.8 billion about dogs. So,
yeah, people going, why are cats shit? Why did I get a cat? How can I get rid of this cat?
Did a cat slap you when you were a baby?
What's the best way to date a cod?
Oh.
Where did you find a slutty fishmonger?
There are plenty.
All these whores of the sea can be yours.
You do them up like that, they fly out the shop. Given the choice of two cod.
Yeah,
come
which
on.
One?
I have Lady Penelope there. Something to do with eyes or ears. That's our theme.
You're smart.
They have no ears,
well...
The size of them.
Holmes?
Ears is... Right, they have an ear bone.
They have an ear bone?
They have an ear bone. But what's interesting is that you can age a cod to within a day using this method. So it's even better than trees, which, as we know, is a year. The otolith is a bone that we all have. It helps us give us a sense of which way our head
All of us cod.
No, all of us. All of living things. In fish, including cod, it gets this calcium carbonate build-up. And if you, unfortunately, you have to kill the cod first, and then you bake its otolith, and then under a microscope, you can tell its age to within a day.
What, and then you go, oh, it's his birthday, I'll get him a present.
Oh, yes. Cod used to be so plentiful. Alexandre Dumas, who wrote an encyclopedia of gastronomy, said you could walk from France to America on cod. They were so, you could see them and you sailed. They
well,
were
that,
just,
that ended in disaster.
Yes,
of course.
It did.
The deaths of many young people.
Yes.
Essentially, the cod wouldn't cooperate.
Yeah.
You know, it was theoretically possible, but the organisational challenge was too great. And they're slippy, even if they will lie nicely on the surface.
It's true. It's not going to happen.
Back to boats, you know.
No, but it'd be brilliant, though. It'd be like, you could just, like, run and then slide on them for a bit and then go up and run. It'd be the best journey to America ever.
Like wheelie trainers.
Oh, yes.
It has a U, two T's and three I's. And here we are in its habitat.
What I'd like, just before we continue, is some sort of deal that you're not going to make the klaxon.
The klaxon, or you don't like that?
Well, I think I'll just jump and it will be nerve-wracking. And I'll jump in your lap. You won't like it.
Okay.
None of it's good.
So, what I'll do, if it's... for something with a U, two T's and three I's.
Is it a creature with three I's?
It is a creature. So there's the beginning.
A tuatara.
Tuatara, let's get very well done.
Yeah.
It does have three eyes. Do you know any more about it? Have you seen one or...?
I have held one, yes.
Right.
It's at gunpoint.
It does have a sort of... third.
Yes, it has a third. At the very top of its head, it's what's called a parietal eye or possibly a pineal eye. But it can't actually see particularly well out of it. Mostly, it can distinguish light and darkness. Phil?
There is a red circle around nothing on that lizard.
This is eye.
QI Trump like ruse.
It's there. Where? Yeah. You can see it there.
Yeah.
That's a freckle.
No, it's not.
Is that its old fella? It doesn't have six penises, if that's what you're saying. You know what? The weird thing is, that's his ass. It's got eight asses.
Yeah. It's going to upset you, Phil, but most lizards have a third eye, too. Well, to a greater or lesser extent.
Yeah. You know that.
As do lampreys, lots of frogs.
Oh, I see.
Do you see?
That is an eye.
Yeah, look, see? There. That's it, there. There it is.
There is an eye, right there. Yeah.
Right there.
Yes.
There's another one there. Look! I've got one! Put me on there! Unbelievable!
Do bacteria talk about...
Is it Love Island?
Other bacteria who aren't in the room.
I love it when, by complete chance, you're correct. So they are communicating about where the other bacteria are. It's something called quorum sensing. They actually emit and detect each other's chemical signals. And what they basically do is they take a head count. to see how many bacteria there are, and they base their activity on how many bacteria they have detected around them.
Like a fight, like there's 10 of us and 4 of them.
It's like the army gathering and going, right, we're ready to go over the top now because we've got enough. Lots of bacteria that cause human diseases, so cholera, pneumonia, staph infections and so on, and they use quorum sensing, so they wait harmlessly inside us until they agree that there's enough. And then they go. It's a bit like social media, right? So one person tweets, but then it is repeated and repeated and repeated till it goes viral, and you have enough to make it a story for a lazy journalist. It was very first observed in the 1970s. There are some bacteria called Vibrio fischeri, and they live in the bodies of the Hawaiian bobtail squid. Isn't that beautiful?
Wow. Mm.
So the squid gives them accommodation and sugar and amino acid for food, and in return, the bacteria gives the squid the most ingenious defense mechanism by glowing all of them all at once and generating bioluminescence. So the squid is able to control this light, which is created by all these bacteria living there, and basically any potential predator that is looking up at the squid will think it's looking at the moon, because the squid can point this light downwards. Isn't it clever?
Smart.
I know. So it's working with bacteria in order to do this trick. It's called counter-illumination. And the squid can even use its ink to dim the lights. And it's useless for the bacteria to glow unless there's enough of them.
That seems like a really fair payment.
Yeah.
Like, you get that incredible party trick just from getting some bacteria. Like, if I got that every time I'd have thrush, I would...
I am so in love with the idea of getting thrush and suddenly being bioluminescent.
Yeah. It would definitely be literally the silver lining.
Yes.
It'd be also a conversation start, because I'd walk in and I'd go, Holly, you look great. Got through the thrush?
She looks like the moon, but she's so itchy. Oh, wow.
Product which put Kendall on the map.
I'm being pointed at.
Let's do it one letter at a time.
Yeah.
I love saying that word as well. Those words together.
You do you?
Yeah.
Well, I have no idea what you're talking about.
You're nearly what you've done. Kendall Mint Cake.
What? There is a mince cake which went up Everest to the first, the conquering of Everest, and Scott took
very
on the...
Very high sugar. It's good for giving you energy when you're up a mountain.
It's rather delicious, actually.
I see.
But it's not what put Kendall on the map, as it were. Kendall became famous for another product. And it's actually extraordinary. It's a machine that was built in 1750 and is possibly the oldest still-working machine in the world. It's still producing the same stuff now. It was actually built to make gunpowder. But quite early on in its life, it was schlepped down to Kendall by ass or donkey, and then started to make what it still makes to this day, which is of the same consistency as gunpowder.
That map's only of any use, really, if you're going driving to Kendall.
If you're
going...
Right. It's not much use for anything else. Yeah. And even then, it's pretty vague.
I used to sell those maps, and people would come in and go, and I'm going to Birmingham, and I'd go... No, you can't. Yeah.
I've only got a Kendall map.
Do you use it in the home?
We nowadays very rarely use it. It was the most popular form of delivery of this drug up until about 1900.
Nicotine?
Nicotine is the right answer. Oh. How is nicotine most delivered?
Snuff.
Kendall has a snuff mill that has been going since 1750 and still produces snuff.
Ah, the old Kendall snuff mill.
The old Kendall snuff mill.
I knew that.
I have some snuff for you to try in different flavours. You can see whether the lid is lying or not. The special QI lids. You can take it if you want. You obviously inhale it up the nose.
You do it all, right?
Oh.
You got to see it all.
Don't do it all, no. It's very sharp. It is. It's sharp. Oh, you're licking it. Gums. Oh, moustache. It is quite sharp. You have got, what's your flavour say?
It says Christmas pudding.
You got Christmas pudding? That's terrible.
Honestly, it's fine. It's good. Put it in your eyes.
This is probably the only time my nan's going to watch me on telly and I'll be like that the whole show.
What do you reckon, Colin?
Oh, that is the... This flavour says kitty litter.
Oh, that is awful. You're not a fan?
I'm not a fan. It says champagne.
Yeah, they're different. So many, I mean, hundreds, thousands of different flavours or sorts, as they're called. What does it say on the lid, Danielle?
Flavour?
Yeah.
Jealousy.
Oh. Klein.
Whiskey and honey.
Whiskey and honey? Yeah. Does it take... yours,
no, not
Ross,
really.
When you've come down...
I can't see! I can't see anything!
We start in the Kalahari, so tell me, how did the meerkat cross the road?
Carefully.
That's not a life-size one, is it?
That's not well, it is a life-size one.
Really, I'd say it was in the foreground, except there's a bit of road before it.
Yes, it's confusing,
it's
isn't it?
It's just a very tiny car.
Do
they cross in a group? Like you know when you see those kids in the reflective jackets?
Yes.
Snaking across the road with some sort of handler. I think that's what children have.
Well, meerkats are, despite their cutesy reputation, they're pretty mean, fierce animals. And they have levels of superiority. And the leading meerkat sends across the less important meerkat to test the road. And it's the youngsters.
That'll be you tonight,
do you want me
John.
To test it tonight?
It's your children. First time. You have to cross the set.
Unbelievably, it's the children they send.
The children?
They send their little
once
children.
Again, that'll be me tonight.
Well, we do please. The same. We do the same with buggies, right? You push them straight out to the road before you.
So what are they testing? That it's not going to get hit by a car?
Yeah, exactly. Basically, that it's safe. And if the youngsters get gobbled, they go, oh, I'm not going there.
They not understand that there might be another car in a minute.
It seems odd, but...
Well, that one's been killed by a car, so we'll all be fine.
Are the tiny meerkats wearing high-vis jackets like human children do, or do they just rely on their own gorgeousness?
I think they rely on their own gorgeousness. But the leading, the sort of head, not exactly... you sit there going, ah...
I don't fancy that one at the bottom's chances, if that's all right.
Exactly. He knows he's about to be sent.
That one behind him's just about to do that.
You have alpha females with meerkats. And, in fact, they kill each other's children.
What?
Yes, they're pretty nasty animals when it comes to it, I'm afraid. They're not very nice at all. They're child murderers, to be perfectly honest.
Here are three young meerkats crossing the...
Two have spotted the vehicle.
Who are the youngest one?
Barry did not.
Unfortunately, because of the adverts, a lot of people have bought them as pets. And they very soon abandon them because they're smelly, they're aggressive, and they attack people
yeah,
they don't know.
Yeah, but you know what? These people like have never died crossing a road, have they?
No, they haven't, exactly.
And the meerkat always worried that someone's about to kick them in the knackers.
Do you have that look to it?
Looks like someone's about to take a free kick, doesn't it?
It does. The only thing that could make that picture even more gorgeous would be three tiny pianos.
Meerkats know each other by their calls individually, and you can send a meerkat almost insane by recording one meerkat's voice that it knows, playing it in a certain area, and then whizzing round to another area and playing it again. And
why
it
would you do that such a thing?
It's very mean, but they get utterly baffled by the fact...
Barry!
How can we be in two places at once? There is no meerkat called Barry, by the way, but
you could do that with a human voice, because we recognise everyone through their voices.
True,
as well,
but
we
also know about recordings. Can you name anyone who's actually read his own premature obituary? Has anyone ever read their own obituary while being alive?
I'd be surprised if there's someone who was presumed dead during the war or something and then came back.
Might have been found, yes. Well, there are two stories. One was that Alfred Nobel read his own obituary and was described as being a merchant of death because he invented...
Dynamite.
Dynamite, yes, exactly. And he was so horrified, and he wasn't dead, that he instituted the Nobel Prizes in order to try and reclaim his name. But that is not, in fact, a true story, but it's a myth. The other one is Marcus Garvey, the Jamaican black nationalist, apparently died as a result of reading his obituary. He had a stroke when he read the Chicago Defender newspaper,
which printed his obituary describing him as broke, alone and unpopular.
Oh!
That's terribly sad.
It's like Googling yourself.
Yeah.
Mum would just say, it's safe to come out now.
Yeah.
He's gone, honest.
It would have friends who knew him said, yes, he really was like that.
I did say the other day, driving through Islington and there was a hearse slowing everything down, and I did say to my wife, if it's my funeral, tell the Pope driving the hearse to step on it. I would not.
You should, instead of having a coffin as well, just have the body so that as you're going around the corners, you're slamming against it.
Can you rent some chickens? Get some chickens in a cage, you know, some boxes to drive them, just make it
like an A-team final, yeah. What music do you want your coffin to go, when your coffin goes into the, disappears?
The Sweeney theme.
That would be a good one. Da-da-dang.
Well, when my dad...
The end music, you know, when it's really slow.
Da-da-da-dang. when the foot presses on the accelerator.
I quite like the music from Allo Allo with You Have Been Watching. When my dad died, he's a big fan of sailing, so we gave him a Viking send-off. We put his ashes in a boat and tried to set fire to it, but because it was in the North Sea, it wouldn't light. So what we did was we were trying to fill the boat full of his ashes, and we're going, do you tip the ashes straight into the boat or do you put them in bags? And my mum, who's ever the practical, she went, I've got some sandwich bags. I'll get some sandwich bags. So we packed him in the boat, and then we went out to sea, and off he went and shot off into the distance.
Was it a remote control boat?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it was a remote control boat. Like a proper big yacht.
And I just, yeah, no,
the word for
you sent your dad off with 4 AA's.
Yeah, we did.
Keep going till the batteries run out.
Luckily,
you're there with an air rifle.
Hey,
like
and
that.
The people from the miniature village were going, help that man, someone help
me. The lifeboat comes out.
Did you not argue over who used the remote control? That wouldn't work in our family. Give it here, you're doing it wrong. It was my dad too. Give us a go.
The word dignity is not the first in your...
No, but this is the thing. That's exactly what he would have wanted, and I've said the same thing. Like Hunter S. Thompson, you know, when he died, Hunter S. Thompson was put in a cannon and just fired off across the valley that he used to own. And what I'd quite like to do is I'd like to be put in, like, pepper spray, and then, you know, just people that I don't like, I'm going to get my wife to go, like that. That's for a noble.
Who wrote the songs I'm Leaning on a Lamppost and When I'm Cleaning Windows?
Yeah. Definitely not George Formby, even though his wife, Beryl, insisted that George had a credit so that he'd get money.
You're absolutely right. I happen to know you're a bit of a fan of George Formby, aren't you?
I am indeed, yeah.
Yeah, I'm Leaning on a Lamppost was one of his big hits, as is When I'm Cleaning Windows.
When I'm Cleaning Windows, is that the one that's really a bit dodgy?
Well, there was a phrase in here, the blushing bride, she looks divine, the bridegroom, he is doing fine, I'd rather have his job than mine when I'm cleaning windows. The BBC banned it. However, George Formby was invited to do a performance at Windsor in front of the royal family in 1941 and some troops during the war, obviously, and the Queen Mother insisted he sing the song properly, not with any cut verses. And she liked it so much, she asked him to sing it another 2 or 3 times, but the BBC still banned it. Now, you're a special group, George Formby fans, and it's usual amongst George Formby fans, I believe, that they teach themselves the banjolele. And as a you are one, we have a banjolele. Can you delight us with some Formby?
Am I on the spot?
I don't know if it's tuned or not, but I mean, just do what
you can. Don't worry about that.
We'd be very happy.
My dog has fleas is what you need to remember. My dog has... Well, this one doesn't have fleas, he has distemper. When I'm cleaning windows, it's got another bit that goes... 8 o'clock, a girl awakes at 8:10. A bath she takes at 8:15. My ladder breaks when I'm cleaning windows. Hey. There's a bit that goes... There's a famous movie queen. She looks a beauty on the screen. She's more like 80 than 18 when I'm cleaning windows. says. She takes her hair down all behind, then takes down her never mind, and finally takes down the blind when I'm cleaning with you.
Cheeky! Brilliant. There is a tradition, I don't know how much it exists in other languages, whether it is a peculiarly English thing, of the tradition of Frankie Howard, Carry On and so on.
They can be very clever, though, those
innuendos.
Do you remember that? There used to be a form of joke, and it used to be, she was only a so-and-so's daughter.
She was only a roadmender's daughter, but she liked having her asphalt, or whatever it was.
That's it.
She was only a fishmonger's daughter, but she could lay it on the slab and say fillet.
Yes.
I'll get two little leg holes cut.
How's that suitcase moving along the road?
Now, for a question about roulette. OK, I will give you 10 points to gamble on the next roll of this wheel. I can tell you that these are all black. These are the ones, the last ones that have come up, the last five. What would you bet on now? Would you bet on black or red?
I think it doesn't matter.
That is correct. So why do you think that is? A lot of people would say red.
There's some gambler's fallacy, isn't there? There's some kind of gambler's myth. I grew up spending a lot of time standing outside Ladbrokes waiting for my dad on a Saturday morning. But there's a gambler's myth that if you've lost a certain number of times, you must be due a win.
Yeah.
But actually, whether it's black or red or whatever, what's gone before bears no relationship to the probability of what's going to happen next.
It's new every time, is it?
Well, yeah. The wheel doesn't remember what it did before, yeah. So it has. It's 50-50. It's red or it's going to be red or black.
Could that then suggest, Sandi, yeah, I may as well not wear my lucky pants if I'm doing something.
Give up.
Today, for example, Sandi, because I enjoy QI and I want to do well to impress you, I'm wearing my lucky pants.
Right.
If what you're saying is correct about the fact nothing matters, I may as well not bother wearing these pants that I've had for 20 years.
I can't believe that the lucky pant fallacy has finally come clear to you.
And I think corduroy against the screen is right.
Yes, yes. You don't need pants, do you, Giles? Not at all. I'm afraid it is pretty much a 50-50 bet.
Does it matter?
No, I'm so sorry. Although it's not quite a 50-50 bet because there is also a zero, and that is how they actually make their money in the casinos. But you're absolutely right, darling, the gambler's fallacy. If the wheel has landed on black six times, 85% of people will bet on red.
I'm not allowed in casinos.
Hmm?
I'll tell you why I'm not allowed in casinos.
You can't see it over the table.
No, it's not.
Falling into the roulette wheel. How's that Stetson going round and round?
My first time in a casino, like a proper casino, I had a credit card for the first time and I ran up £10,000 in 6 hours.
No.
I mean, I was very young and I was very stupid and I was quite drunk. And after that, I decided I liked it so much I would never go back into one again because I loved every single second. They gave me lobster, they gave me beer. I thought it was amazing.
Wow.
I've been once, I've only once played roulette and in extraordinary circumstances. It was quite recently. My wife and I went for a wedding anniversary to Barbados. We were on the beach, sun was setting, wonderful golden sand, and this little old wizened lady came teetering along the beach towards us, and it wasn't until she got to about here that we realised it was actually Mick Jagger. This is a true story. And it turned out he was a really enthusiastic viewer of Countdown, so he knew who I was. And I obviously knew who he was, and my wife was quite excited. So anyway, we went off for the evening, and we went to a casino with Mick Jagger, and he very sweetly gave us the chips. And of course, we lost, but it didn't seem to bother him, which was fantastic.
That's amazing.
Lovely. Yeah.
You come down to breakfast, you look in the goldfish bowl, and you find your goldfish floating on its side on the surface of the water. Yes. What's the matter with it?
You got it from a fairground. It's dead.
Oh!
dead?
No.
So when I flushed it?
Yeah, probably. A lot of people throw away the living ones.
It's asleep.
They're sort of stunned, or they're ill. They've got their balance. Ill. Their balance is all wrong.
And where did they get the balance from? It's what's called their swim bladder.
Swim bladder, yes.
It's swim bladder disorder. Yeah. What happens is if they're overfed, they get constipation, and it affects their swim bladder, and they can't move, and they just lie on their side completely still. And a lot of people think they're dead and throw them away, as you might have done. But actually, with 3 days of no food, they usually get all better.
Yeah.
But the fact is, of course, as you probably know, it's very easy to overfeed a goldfish. Their stomachs are the same size as their eyes. Tiny little stomachs.
Weird's happened to our fish. We came out one morning, and then they were on the side, like this, sort of, like they drunk or something. And then we thought that the cat had had, or the heron perhaps had had a go at them.
Had a pet
heron? We've had a, we're not a pet heron. No. That would be foolish.
Had you given them like a burger the night before or something?
thrown a curry at them.
Might you have overfed them?
I think we probably had overfed them slightly. Yes. Some children had been around.
Oh, and, children love
and they love
fish.
Feed the fish. Oh, do you want to feed the fish? No.
Whole packet of it.
And of course they're fine now because we've worked out the fantastic heron deterrent. We had a problem, terrible problem with the heron. The heron kept coming down and eating the fish. So we ought to put mesh over, and of course your nephew had no idea what that was. And put the mesh, nothing. No, that was no good. He got through the mesh. So eventually we tried to put a fake heron, and the fake heron, thinking that that would be the solution, but that had the opposite effect. That attracted three or four heron who were circling around, going, "Whoa, she's gorgeous," you know. And, standing there, or is she still? The way she stands there, it's all so still. And so we got rid of the fake heron, and then we got a fake crocodile for $7.99. Works a treat. The heron is terrified of this crocodile.
Brilliant.
Works an absolute treat. Just below the surface, and the heron thing. Oh,
and the goldfish don't mind.
No, they're absolutely fine.
Rather terrifying one. My father had some fish that he loved. He used to sit and watch the Know About That long and gold. So I suppose they were goldfish, really, weren't they? They swam around in his pond and there were lilies and he used to watch them. And I thought it would be nice one birthday to buy him some more fish to go in his pond, perhaps a bit different. So I went and found these things called ghost koi.
Oh, yeah. We've got ghost koi.
You've got ghost koi. Now, in the sort of washing-up bowl they sell them in, they're there, they're plainly visible. You can see them swimming around, they've got quite nice markings, like a tiger shot. You know, half a dozen of those or a dozen of those, whatever. I took them home, put them in the pond, where they completely disappear. You can't see them.
Gone.
But what ghost koi do is kill all other fish. So my father was then left with a puddle full of invisible fish, and all his fish were dead. It was the least successful birthday present I ever got.
But you are absolutely right, Brian. Of course, there are zoologists who spend their life trying to understand communications of various species. Do you know what this species is?
The gopher.
It is a gopher. Yeah. A prairie dog.
A prairie dog.
It's also known as a ground squirrel. It's a type of squirrel.
Isn't ground squirrel a condiment?
A little ground squirrel is.
I tell you what, he's only making that face because he's got Philip Schofield's hand up his bum.
Oh, that takes me back a bit.
Is that what the squeaking noise is? It?
No, when I say that to you, I don't mean there was a time. It's all gone wrong. Anyway, there is a scientist, Professor Kon Slobodchikov of Northern Arizona University, who spent 30 years studying the language of these prairie dogs. These
Do they warn squirrels. One another of predators?
Yes,
is that one of the words?
He's used computer analysis, and they're able to distinguish between different types of predator. Humans, badgers, various other animals. Not only that, different geometric shapes, right? And
they have a different sound.
Different coloured shirts that humans are wearing. Badger. And the noise
Human.
We heard...
Human!
The noise we heard in Prairie Dog was, there is a human approaching wearing a yellow shirt. I know that sounds almost inconceivable.
It is.
But what's interesting is they can't distinguish between different genders of humans. But they can in different height. So if a tall human approaches in a yellow shirt, the leader who's on the lookout will make a series of squeaks. And under computer analysis, you can differentiate between a tall human approaching in a red shirt and a short human in a red shirt.
How wide is that?
And a tall human in a yellow shirt and a short one, and so on.
Apparently, if a transvestite in tartan approaches, they explode.
Yes. Man-made artifacts can be seen from the moon with the naked eye.
Yes. Someone said it in the audience.
What was it?
Great Wall of China.
Oh, you've done it again! I can't believe it!
Yes. Which moon are we talking about?
Paul, I think I love you. That's a damn good... you've got to have 10 for that. The fact is, nothing man-made could be seen on Earth from the moon.
Too far away.
It's much, much too far away. Even the continents are quite difficult
Why
to make
would
out.
You want to eat in a restaurant with a heavy fork and nothing fresh on the menu?
A great way, chef.
Is it because you're in space?
The great restaurant in space.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Much about space or restaurants.
Clearly.
But, but if there was one, then the heavy fork would stop it floating away.
Does it really work that with gravity? No. Well, there is gravity or there isn't.
Yes.
If the people are floating away, the fork's not going to be staying. Your sprouts are going to be all over while you can't lift your fork.
No, no sprouts. This is just like the toothpaste that astronauts
so
have.
What do you need the fork for?
To open the toothpaste.
Like somebody direct from NASA. Mark, what do you reckon?
I think the space thing sounded quite plausible.
You like that, do you think?
Yeah, because in space you can't have anything fresh.
Okay. They grow things in space.
It's
don't
nothing
they?
To do with space! Philip, help me out.
I'd love to help you out.
Go on.
So,
then.
So are we talking about like game?
Is it a fork or
yes,
is it another?
It isn't
a fork in the road.
Is it to do with space? I've had some very difficult TV appearances, but my glasses normally do stay on.
She starts throwing the hat around, you know you're in trouble, Mark Watson.
OK, none of this is working. there is a computer scientist, his name is Dan Jarafsky, and he looked at the description of dishes on 6,500 menus, and the higher-end restaurants, they tend not to describe food as fresh. They don't describe it as tasty, they don't describe it as ripe, because the customers in the high-end restaurants expect it to be those things. In fact, in posh restaurants, they tend to use kind of sexy terminology. So if food is sort of sensuous or silky, they use language like that.
Nude.
Yeah. Nude, yes. Yeah. Don't care for a nude aubergine.
We got a topless chicken and we put it under the grill. Ooh, it's been naughty.
This sandwich will wank you off.
Okay. Yes. We've all thought it. We've all thought it.
Oh, my God!
What's wrong with... No! OK, moving on. In posh restaurants, they use a completely different language. And here is the bizarre thing. People enjoy their food more with heavy cutlery. So there's a guy called Charles Michel, and he is the chef in residence at Oxford University's Crossmodal Research Laboratory. So what they are researching is how our different senses modulate any appreciation of flavour. And so he gave everybody exactly the same meal. And people who used heavy cutlery were willing to pay 15% more for their food. It is one of the most bizarre things.
Yeah, was there any point when the fork became too heavy? Because I reckon there is like a, that is a scale that actually, by the time you've got like a garden fork, people are then refusing to pay again.
What you might have done now inadvertently is inspired cheap restaurants to glue their forks to the table to get the illusion.
Or glue two forks together, thereby doubling the weight.
Yeah.
One of the ways that restaurants trick you into spending a bit more money, did anybody know?
Hypnotism.
What?
Hypnotism.
Hypnotism.
Would you like the veal? I mean,
I'd certainly order it after
Absolutely,
that.
Absolutely, yeah.
Now, one of the things they do is they remove the pound sign from menus.
Oh, yeah.
So they did a study at Cornell University, and if it just has the numbers, somehow we don't associate that with the true cost of something.
Yeah, you think it might just be 2.4 ants or something.
Our brain kind of doesn't turn that into dollars or pounds. If you put $20, then you suddenly think about the price, but if you just have the number, subconsciously, we don't think about the cost of things.
Name all the members of the monstrous regiment of women.
Beryl.
Linda.
Jean.
Shirley.
Angry Sue.
She's the leader.
Have you heard of the monstrous regiment? No. The first blast of the trumpet against the monstrous...
John Knox?
Yes, John Knox. I knew you would have. The first blast of the trumpet against the monstrous...
Monstrous regiment of women. Monstrous. OK, so I've read that, and it's bad that I couldn't remember the monstrous regiment. It seems like it's kind of the main part. Do you... It seems like...
Oh. Actually, what it is a slight change in the language, and monstrous doesn't mean monstrous, as we would say. It means unnatural.
Mm.
And regiment doesn't mean the whole load of them marching on, these women. It means regime.
Right.
And he was a Protestant. And he was angry at the fact there were two Catholic women on the thrones of England.
Course.
Who might they have been?
Mary.
Which Mary? They were both called Mary.
Two Marys.
The two Marys.
Exactly. This has now turned into a story from the Bunty.
There was our Mary, Bloody Mary. Bloody Mary, Mary Tudor, the one who burned the Protestants. Mm. And in Scotland, it wasn't Mary Queen of Scots, it was her regent, who was Mary of Guise. Awesome.
Cheery bunch.
Yeah, cheery.
I feel like that's the same Mary in different outfits.
Yeah. You know, when they do like those style challenges on This Morning and it's before and after.
She used to just wear monochrome, but look at her now.
So Knox, who was a very keen Protestant, didn't like these women on the throne. He was angry about it and wrote this thing. But on the subject of Mary Queen of Scots, do you remember who her husband was? Darnley, his name was, her husband. He was murdered. He was actually blown up. This is a very extraordinary story. One of the presumed architects of the explosion was a fellow called Archibald Douglas. A pair of his shoes were found at the scene of the crime. He gave an account of...
Where's your shoes, Archibald? That's old kit!
He didn't take your shoes off before dynamite.
Yeah, he got away with it. But he later gave an account of Mary's reaction. So this is Mary. Her husband has been blown up.
Mm-hmm.
She sent for a number of light ladies and women to come to Holyrood House and participate stark naked in a ball. Then they had cut off their pubic hair and had put it in puddings to be eaten by the male guests who were sick.
Is that what you do when your husband's blown up? Was she just trying to get back to normal life? First, let's just carry on as we were.
Yeah, that's right.
Get your pubes and put them in that pie.
It's what he would have wanted.
Actually, I think this would be quite clever. Probably, if your partner is killed in a horrific way, all anyone's ever going to talk to you about is, oh, what happened to your husband? But now, no.
Yeah.
Why do you have that pube party? Why did that pube party? Well, why was it in jail?
It's all the detail we have.
One, condolences, number two.
It's all the detail we have, Sandi. But the actual person who took the rap for the murder, it was hanged, drawn and quartered on the basis that he was the one who discovered the scene, which seems a bit unfair.
Oh, really?
His name was William Blackadder.
Oh.
It's true. In the Battle of the Bulge, who were the stomach division?
The Germans.
They were a German division, a German...
A regiment of darts players.
They were a division. Like that, yeah. Certainly a good description.
Jockey Wilson, Eric Bristow.
So we're clear on what the Battle of the Bulge was.
Battle of the Bulge is in Belgium, the Second World War.
Yes.
When the Allies were advancing and the Germans went for one big counter-offensive.
The last great counter-offensive.
And it was the largest
land
battle.
It was quite successful. It was so successful that they made a film about it.
it delayed the Americans. It was the largest infantry battle in American military history and the bloodiest. 600,000 Americans were involved, which is more than the whole of the Battle of Gettysburg.
Yeah.
Let's face it, had Americans on both sides.
Yeah.
It was called the Bulge because...
Because the battle line was drawn out like that and the Bulge was the
That's right, the German advance counterattack was made a bulge in the line. We're talking about very late 1944, exactly. Yeah. And so the Stalin's Red Army is pushing through east through Poland and towards Germany. And there's so few men, there's so few German soldiers left after all this fighting,
yes,
that they decide that they must use people who are, who've got a sick note, but it's only for a very slight problem, like a little tummy bug. And so all the people with who were off sick, who had stomach problems, were marshalled into a division of the 70th Infantry of the Wehrmacht, yeah, called the Stomach Division.
They all had the
runs. They had to fight.
Well, and for this, they, of course, displayed outstanding guts, you might say. but they were given their own latrines and their own special diet. And they...
And are given a wide berth by most of the other
women. So they were called the Stomach Division because they were ill.
Yeah.
And they were called up at the last minute.
They were called up. Yeah, that's right. I mean, there are various things, like if you had a leg missing or, you know, very severe, yeah, illnesses, you would be exempt. But they reckoned
that... But a bit of windy pops. The German... Get out there.
Exactly. Durchfall.
Get stuck in, son.
Durchfall is the rather good word, German word for diarrhoea, which just means literally...
Durchfall.
Throughfall.
Durchfall.
So, you're right. It was the Wehrmacht 70th Infantry that were known as the Stomach Division.
Ah.
Due to indisposition, they were unable to attend the Battle of Bulge itself.
Yes.
All 10,000 of them were mopped up by the Canadians.
I mean, good reason to put a frog's bottom in your mouth.
Do you remember posing for that?
I remember that. What a night that was. Yeah. See what I've got in my hands. Yeah.
Oh! Is it breathing underwater? Because if you were swimming along, you grabbed a frog and sucked all the air out of it, keep going.
You've just got to swap round your elements, your Aristotelian elements. You said you're in water, sucking air out of a frog. Imagine you're in air,
sucking water.
You're in the desert, you're in the Australian desert.
Right.
And there's a number of species of frog who, in order to kind of prepare themselves for the dry season ahead, store a huge amount of liquid in the form of actually urine, but very weak urine. Yeah. As you can see, they swell up quite a lot. And as Aboriginals have discovered, if you find one of these and you're very, very dry, you literally put it like that and suck its bottom and you basically, get you like get a lovely drink.
It's essentially a Capri Sun.
Yes. That's what it is.
It's washier than a fruit.
You just get a straw and you can make a hole wherever you want.
It's Cyclorana platycephalus, the little round frog with the flat head, essentially, also known as the water-holding frog.
Presumably, though, the photo of it, I see, is the one after all of the water he'd carefully stored inside, and he's there all loose and going, oh, well, thanks. And then he's to go find more water again.
It is a bit mean, isn't it?
Yeah.
It buries itself under the ground in that condition in the summer and kind of sleeps, which is the opposite of hibernating, and there are points at stake. For those of you who can tell me what the summer version of hibernating is. Hibernating is from...
Lobinating.
Oh, that's a good... It's logical, again. Lobinate. Yes. Hibernating?
Etonation.
You're so close, yes. Your audience knows, I expect.
It's squashing in a minute.
Estivation, they're saying there. Okay. Yeah, very good, yeah.
Rob, what's the difference between a Carlisle surprise, a reverse Canterbury pleasure, and a sheep tied to a lamppost in Cardiff?
Now, this is another example of the institutionalised racism which is accepted when it's directed towards the Welsh, as it has been done. Is this a reference to the joke about what is a sheep tied to a lamppost in Cardiff? It's a leisure centre.
It's also
No. And you know.
No.
You know. No. What is the difference? Well, the only thing I have knowledge of is the sheep type. No, I mean, I have knowledge of Cardiff. I don't. Well, I'm not really aware what a Carlisle surprise is, other than the shock of finding yourself at Carlisle. Which would be surely more of a delight than anything else.
Yes, a total delight.
A reverse Canterbury.
The full name is a reverse Canterbury pleasure, place double. It's an ancient English pastime.
Was it Morris dance? Is it a type of Morris dance?
Not Morris dancing, no. It has musical
breakdance
nature. It's not a dance. It's really big. It's as big a musical instrument as you could ever find.
A whale. I said with a whale, you just put your hand over the blowhole. The whale joined in.
He's making jokes about whales.
Yeah.
No. The name for this pastime comes from originally from the Latin for countryside, but a particular part of the Latin countryside called Campania. And so it's called
bells,
campanology.
Bells.
Absolutely yes, right. It's bell ringing.
Yes. Bell ringing.
Bell ringing. It's bells are, well, and they're tunes, or rather methods, as bell ringers call them. They're uniquely English. And if you have six bells, there are how many different permutations of six bells? Well, six times five times four times three times two.
Lots and lots.
720.
Oh.
And if you play through each one of those permutations, that's called a peal of bells, and it's also called an English phrase we use quite a lot, ringing the changes, because those sequences are called changes. That's where the phrase to ring the changes comes from.
Quite interesting.
Because if you have 12 bells, there are 479,001,600 variations, so that would take 38 years to ring a peal of 12 bells.
Wow.
Amazing thought, isn't it?
When I was growing up, if my dad hit his thumb with a hammer, which he didn't do often, but occasionally just for a bit of something a bit different, you know, you'd do it, he would say, hell's bells and buckets of blood.
It's a good phrase, hell's bells and buckets of blood. It sounds good, doesn't it? It's a good way of getting out of his system. Yeah. I'd say, anyway, so apart from the Bible, what do you suppose was the most successful, the best-selling book in all of England in the 16th century?
The Little Book of Syphilis.
The Highway Code?
Yeah, no.
The Highwayman Code.
The Highwayman Code. BG. It was a book of etiquette for school children, in fact, written by the great Dutch humanist Erasmus. Erasmus, it says on my card here, and I'm rather pleased to know this, he was a Dutch humanist and theologian, it says here, who was immensely influential in the Reformation, and is the second most famous alumnus of Queen's College, Cambridge, after...
You.
Yes! Well, isn't that exciting? But... A, that's not true. They're just trying to be sweet, and I don't have a portrait up.
So, so what, this book was designed to teach children how to behave?
Yes. Would you like to hear some of its pearls of wisdom?
Love to, yeah.
Do not be afraid of vomiting. It is not vomiting, but holding the vomit in your throat that is foul.
No, what's foul is when you try and stop it.
Oh, and it seeps through the fingers.
No, it flies off my mouth.
That's horrible.
If you're on a tube or something and you wait to get to the station and you just can't wait and think, oh, better to hold it in, and suddenly the pressure, it sprays. It sprays over everybody around you. Did he not put that in his book?
He didn't. You should not offer your handkerchief to anyone unless it has been freshly washed. Nor is it seemly, after wiping your nose, to spread out your handkerchief and peer into it as if... as if pearls and rubies might have fallen out of your head. Very good. Do not move back and forth on your chair. Doing so gives the impression of constantly breaking or trying to break wind. It does rather. Not as much as doing that does. Yeah. Sideways. Oh, thank you. There we are. Not well. That's all pretending.
I did that in exam once.
Yeah.
Farted and someone thought I was cheating. So I was off. I said I wasn't looking. I was going,
How could I tell that Alan is a criminal just by looking at him?
20 tiny fingers.
A merry criminal, yeah.
Is it the shifty little eyes, pointy nose and general sort of little pug face?
Interesting. totally. A totally unfair reading,
I've never
surely.
Seen you happier. Never been happier. Perhaps I've never seen you.
That one's been building up for over 20 years.
This one
out of that
one day, I'm really going to tell you what I think of it. When will that opportunity arrive? Oh, go on.
Is this like the phrenology?
Well, in fact, I have a phrenological.
Everyone has one of these.
Everyone has one of these. Ooh. This is a copy of the original.
The Melbourne Jail, they've got casts of Ned Kelly and all the murderers.
Absolutely, because in the 19th century, not only phrenology, but of the face, physiognomy. The art of reading character through the face was taken terribly seriously.
Is it his ears? Something to do with his ears?
Nose.
Well, I'll tell you, the father of physiognomy was, of course, one of Alan's best friends, Aristotle.
According to what he said about the face and character, your curly hair signifies someone who is dull of apprehension, soon angry and given to lying and mischief.
Cool, you thought Joe was bad?
Yeah. The distance between your eyebrows, as worked out by the QI elves, is that you are hard-hearted, envious, close and cunning, addicted to cruelty more than love. Oh. Dara.
Yes?
He who has a large, full forehead and a little round withal, destitute of hair, or at least that has little on it, is bold, malicious, high-spirited, full of choler, apt to transgress beyond bounds, and yet of good wit and very apprehensive. There you are.
You threw me a little bun there at the end, didn't you?
Yes.
Like, you are a scumbag, 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 couple of gags, scumbag, scumbag, essentially.
Exactly, yeah. Basically. Whereas Phil, he whose hair groweth thick on his temples and his brow, is by nature simple, vain, luxurious, lustful, credulous, clownish in his speech and conversation, and double chin shows a peaceable disposition, but...
Think on.
Vain, credulous, a great supplanter and secret in all your actions.
And not to mention peckish.
Yeah. Well, there is that. Joe? One whose hair is of reddish complexion is, for the most part, if
but
not always, proud, deceitful, detracting, venerous and full of envy.
Venerous?
Yes, as in venereal, sort of...
Disease?
Yes, to do with...
On to the quest for true love. Who would be interested in this dating profile? Stocky build, short, bald, Bolivian male, moderate drinker, never been in a previous relationship, definitely wants children.
That's basically me.
Is it a human?
No, obviously it's not a human.
All Bolivian creature beginning with a Q.
It doesn't begin with a Q.
Well, it's in the wrong series.
It is. But we are on a quest to find this creature a mate. It is a... frog.
A frog.
Well, so this is a very sweet story, OK? This is a story of Romeo, a Sehuencus frog. So he has been living in a tank in Bolivia in the Cochabamba Natural History Museum, and it was thought that Romeo was the last one in his species. So the last one in his species is called an endling, and in 2018, his conservationist set up an online dating profile for him on Match.com in an effort to find him a mate. And here is the video that they made for their search.
Hi there, I'm Romeo, a Sehuencas water frog from Bolivia. I'm a pretty simple guy. I tend to keep to myself and love spending nights at home. I also love eating. Then again, who doesn't?
Ah, who could resist, right? Who could resist?
They're good friends to do that.
Didn't want to do it himself.
Yeah.
It's embarrassing.
It's embarrassing.
To do it to yourself.
They're good mates.
Get
They're
your friends to do it.
Miguel, could you do a video for me?
Hey, why don't I put it you? Get catchy the worm.
Come out under the rock.
You get the worm.
I have the tiny arms of the frog. It is not possible for me to hold the phone. In the world.
Say what you want me to say.
Yeah. Write it down on a big piece of pepper, hold it behind your phone.
The thing is, it worked.
Loads of frogs started turning up.
Who toad in a frog bra?
Hello.
They went out on a frog-finding expedition. They found three males and two females, and he has now been paired with a female who they have obviously named...
Juliet.
Juliet, exactly right.
See, si, because I am called Romeo. This photograph was taken of me at my modern jazz dance class.
Moving on, where's this guy going with that ox, and what's he going to do when he gets there?
Is it like an early boombox?
I can tell you, as you can see, because he's able to lift it, that the cow has been hollowed out, and why might...
Is it before the invention of birthday cakes? People used to get strippers to jump out of cows.
Yes, it's that.
Not a Hindu wedding.
I hate to say this, but if someone's inviting a stripper to a wedding, that wedding... Is it to scare off animals?
It's quite the reverse. It's to be able
to encourage.
It's to be able to hide. This is Richard Kirtan. He's one of the world's first wildlife photographers. So before the telephoto lens, in order to get a close-up, you literally had to get close up. So if you wanted to take, for example, a photograph of a bird's nest with eggs in it, this is Richard and his brother Cherry Kirtan.
Cherry,
I know. They went, Richard, let's have something different. Cherry. Richard and Cherry, pioneers of wildlife photography, they bought an ox from a butcher. They got a taxidermist to hollow it out, and they hid themselves in the ox with a lens sticking through a hole. And one day, apparently, Richard fainted inside the ox, and it fell over, and his brother... and took the photo before he got his brother out. They more or less invented professional nature photography. Their subjects range from anything from flowers in the Yorkshire Dales to lion hunts in Africa. And before them, most nature photographs were stuffed animals placed in natural surroundings. But you can see they abseiled down cliffs. They had those astonishing fragile box cameras slung to their backs.
He's hot. Like, I'm not going to... Come on.
You think?
Yeah.
Cherry Kirtan became the Attenborough of his age. He moved into wildlife documentaries.
Here, from inside the ox.
Now, what did Harry Houdini hide behind the mirror?
Ooh. We know he was killed by somebody punching him in the stomach.
Boy, wasn't it?
Doing one of his yeah. usual tricks, but he wasn't ready for it.
He hit one of those.
You are right! Yeah. Oh, good. Yeah.
What is it down there?
Well done. Elephant in the room. Very good indeed.
So how did he hide an elephant behind a mirror?
It was his greatest stage illusion. He was said to be not a very good magician, partly because his personality was very tiresome and he just didn't have any panache on stage.
I can't think of any magicians like that today.
Oh, no. He was obviously a great escapologist, but he brought this elephant called Jenny onto stage and instantly she disappeared in front of the audience. And it was a remarkable trick. No one knew how he did it and he didn't reveal the secret. But having said
that... the elephant knew.
Elephant, apparently.
Never forgot.
Actually, Houdini is quoted as saying, even the elephant does not know how it is done.
Yeah.
Essentially, it involved a mirror folding back that revealed an identically done box in the flies of the thing. So it reflected back and made it look as if you were looking at the empty crate.
All done with mirrors.
All done with mirrors, yes. Exactly. And it was impressive for those who sat in the right place.
The best things he did, Houdini, were going around the place exposing charlatans and frauds. That's what he was really good at.
Yeah, absolutely
he
right.
He knew when people were tricking people out of money and conning people.
Well, like all magicians, obviously, you only have to look at someone who claims to be a spiritualist or a mind reader and you know they're just using magic. I mean, it's what Darren Brown does, it's what James Randi does in America. So, who did Harry Houdini come in combative relations to? Because there was a great man of the age who rather tragically did believe in spiritualism and mediums and the dead people being able to talk.
Was it
was a Briton.
It wasn't Conan Doyle.
It was Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of Sherlock Holmes, who sadly devoted the last 20 or 30 years of his life to believing in fairies and spiritualism and things, and Houdini was foursquare against it. But it was a period when a lot of people did sort of believe in this kind of phlogiston.
There's a great story about Conan Doyle, actually. Just for a joke one day, he wrote a note saying, "We are discovered, flee immediately," and he sent it to five of his friends to see what they would do. And one of them disappeared. Brilliant.
Yeah.
And he had no idea why. But
So Houdini, yes, as you were saying, he was punched in the stomach by a student whose name was J. Gordon Whitehead. Apparently he wasn't ready because he claimed he could be punched at any time by anyone and he could take that punch. But this guy just tapped him on the shoulder and went like that before he could tense his muscles. Supposedly, that's what ruptured something and caused peritonitis, though it's now believed that he might actually have had appendicitis already. So it merely just exacerbated it.
Didn't make the student feel any better, though,
did it? Yeah, because but there's been a recent demand to have his body exhumed, and it may even be so.
You never get it out. Never get it out of the coffin.
Hey, very good.
It won't be in there.
But they want to test it for poison because there are those who believe that spiritualists poisoned him because he was giving them such a bad name. But I think that's.
Can you test bones if you've been poisoned?
Oh, you can test bodies for poison because the hair, which never goes away, that retains a lot of poison.
That's what you think.
Very good. Houdini was pretty remarkable, though. He could pick up pins with his eyelashes. eyelash is still attached to his eyes.
Yeah, I can do that.
Yeah, can you? Well, there you are. You're pretty extraordinary. You can also undo
knots. Not much of a stage act, though, is it?
No, but it was a technique he used for his escapology, that's the point.
Oh, I see.
When he was naked and he was bound and he was in a cell, he probably managed to get to the cell beforehand and leave pins almost invisibly there that he could then pick up, manoeuvre down to his mouth, and then use. He could undo knots and thread a needle with
his
toes.
Penis.
Yeah, with his feet, exactly.
No, penis.
Oh, with his penis. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I misread. No, it is actually toes, funny enough. On this occasion, not right, Alan. I don't know how that could be. Anyway, Houdini hid an elephant in the hippodrome and never told. What makes up more than 70% of the internet?
It's my personal collection, isn't it?
Of what?
Of gentlemen's special interest literature.
No, it's just quite surprising. They did a survey on behalf of the American Civil Liberties Union, who were very annoyed about some legislation that Bush was trying to push through, which they thought somewhat prohibitive of personal liberty, and they discovered that less than 1% of the internet is pornography. Less than 1%. Of all email traffic, 89% is spam. It's as simple as that.
Trying to sell you Xanax and penis enlargement.
Exactly. Soft Cialis, whatever that is.
The annoying thing about those, I get loads of them, most of them from my girlfriend, but it's the ones from my mum that really hurt. Oh.
Yay! Oh. Yes, a recent study has established that the World Wide Web is less than 1% pornography, and on the other hand, 89% of all emails are spam, which is good news if you're looking for cheap pills or you want to increase it. What did you use this for? I have a picture of them here.
Oh, it's frighten the children.
It's a German invention.
You put a torch behind it, and then you creep up into their bedroom at night when they're asleep. Well, you move it very slowly across the room.
It's a thing that is used in the lavatory, in the WC. No, it's a habit. It's for men to do something when they go to the lavatory. It's to encourage them.
The seat. Anything to do with the seat?
It is to do with the seat.
To dive off it into the toilet.
No. No. Noble guess, but doomed. No.
Do they sit down in Germany?
It's if they lift the seat, which men tend to do before having a pee. This, I have one here. Here it is.
Hello. This is your toilet speaking. Wouldn't you rather like to sit down? Oh, you prefer to stand? Well, then you may leave now.
Poor German men don't actually get to go to the toilet then, do they? No wonder they're wearing that lederhosen and slapping themselves all the time.
No, the point is, in Germany, they think it's somehow unhygienic because they're splashing and things. They want the men to sit. Mm. So it's like that's how it's attached. So when you lift up the seat, it starts speaking at you loud enough in a public lavatory for others to hear. So the men sit and have a pee. That's
well,
the idea.
Splashing is a problem. We've got builders in at the moment, and they're all using the lower loo. It is like the Centre Park's log flume in there.
Who's still having sex?
Not me.
Not me.
I tell you what, these toads.
They're begging for it.
Begging
for
it.
Are they having it?
Are they having it? Who's still having
sex? Long-term, some animals lock together for ages, don't they? Are we in the animal kingdom?
Well, Alan, you're in absolutely the right area in as much as you spotted our phrase, still having sex, as being having sex in a still position. So it is the species that most has to be utterly motionless when having sex that we could discover.
Is it nuns?
It's not nuns.
It's a moth.
And so
there it is.
Oh, right.
There it is. Beautiful, beautiful moth. It's the gold swift moth. And it's at its most vulnerable when mating, because it might move and exhibit ecstasy. So what it does instead is keep incredibly still so that the bat doesn't spot the twitch and the movement. But it has a wonderful repertoire of positions, sexual positions.
It's
unique amongst, because you don't want to disturb it. Look, there they are.
I think, do you know what? All David Attenborough. As though we were sort of just...
We were there, yes.
I think Stephen's worried about being attacked by a bat.
On the left, then, is the standard facing position. And in the middle, an extraordinary upside down.
See the tiny moth cock.
Mr. Moss and Kate Moss.
Do it. Do it. Yeah.
Thank you. But they are a marvellous species, I think you'd agree. Yeah, the gold swift moth, yeah. It has to remain completely still when having sex. Now, there's something completely different. Who's still having sex?
The gold fish moth, what was it called?
This
God, dementia swift. Already.
Gold swift moth.
The gold swift.
Oh, the gold swift moth.
The gold swift.
You get points for remembering.
Oh.
We are so impressed because it's very rare that anyone I could remember the question that's just been asked.
Oh, I was so close. I said goldfish moth.
I know.
You got, is this a new thing then, master of memory?
Yes, that's right.
Wow.
Yeah, well done you.
Will we get some slightly easier ones, like our names? Because my memory's terrible.
Mine's terrible.
Yeah. Really
such
bad.
A fabulously middle-aged new feature.
Isn't it?
Master of memory.
Well done for remembering something seconds ago.
Is it Neville Chamberlain? anyway.
One of those rave parties.
Biggest news item ever.
Has it got anything to do with the Kardashians?
I'm not even really sure who they are, so no.
When was the golden era of the newspapers? When was, like, the biggest circulation? Would it be Titanic?
So it's not an actual news item that we're looking for, so it's not...
So we're not like the moon landing, which is a very big...
It's not a story. It's the actual news.
Did they do, like, a live broadcast for, like, 36 hours or something?
Is it the size of the headline you're looking for? The size
yes. In fact, you can help me because I actually have a copy of what we're looking for, but I can't manage it on my own. So, Alan and Clive, if you could come and help me. What I'm talking about is the largest newspapers ever published.
Ah.
These were... This is called the Universal Yankee Nation. There you go.
Oh, a tiny print.
Yes. You seriously had to have...
I mean, is this helping
eyesight?
Your presentation to skills?
I don't want to hurt your feelings, but if Stephen was here, his head would be poking over the top.
If I was good, I could have gone underneath, but I didn't want to play limbo with the newspaper.
Why did they design those?
Maybe there was a tax on each page of newsprint.
That's exactly right.
Right.
They were known as blanket sheets or mammoth newspapers or Leviathan newspapers, and it was the introduction of these cylinder printing presses that made them possible. So it was the fact that it was possible. This particular newspaper was only published for about a year and a half, from 1841 to 1842, but it was called the largest paper in all creation.
Would have been very useful if you're an extremely fat tramp that was sleeping.
Yes, except it was only one page thick, so it wasn't...
In the summer.
In the sleeping hour.
Or if you're two tramps having a liaison.
Yes, but they were designed for sharing. But you said about the duties. It's why we had broadsheets.
Yes, there was a tax, wasn't there?
Yeah, there was a tax.
Well, I mean, if you're taxed like that, there'd be people trying to avoid it, though, wouldn't there?
I would imagine,
they would have ways of trying to get around it.
I guess some people would, but I mean, they'd be morally bankrupt is what they'd pay.
They'd get their papers from Jersey or somewhere, so it would be just crazy.
If somebody...
Well, don't work.
So it was a bit like modern fizzy drinks tax. It was to discourage people from buying newspapers because they were so critical of the government. And so that's...
They'll tax them out of existence.
Yeah, for a really long time, 1712 till 1855.
And then when they took off the tax, all the sort of Daily Mails, Daily Mirrors, popular press came in because, relatively poor people could afford to buy the news and find out what's going on.
Yes.
From flying fish to the fishing fly. Ho, ho. Why do women make the best fishermen?
They're all descended from mermaids.
It's a very sweet thing. I don't know that that's true.
I can imagine you whispering that into a girl's ear.
And in 1654, they negotiated a deal with the octopus witch to let them also have the voices back.
I'm still asleep.
I need to write this down.
Teach my kids this.
It must be. This is
16.
It was a massive summit.
It was. You might be right, Johnny. I'm not sure. I'll check.
It was like Rivers of Blood speech because a lot of the macro were told to f***ing short.
What? I see that now. Okay. Okay.
Sorry. I think I actually know this.
Yes, go on. Tell.
I didn't know a lot. he used to get his wife to give him a discarded pubic hair because there was a chemical in it, and he used to hair-rig his boilies fishing for carp because they think that it gives off.
You're absolutely right. This is what people think. You're right. You're right that this is what people think. As it happens, it is completely untrue. Someone wrote a letter to the Field in which he said he'd had huge success using his wife's pubic hairs, and a whole generation of fishermen copied this. And there was a belief that pheromones, which is probably the chemicals you were after, pheromones that women give off. But there are a number of problems with this, chief of which is that there is absolutely no evidence that humans give off pheromones of any kind.
So why are women?
The fact is, the British record for the largest fish caught on these islands is held by women. There was a 64-pound salmon caught by a Miss Georgina Ballantyne. But the fact is, she was a very experienced angler.
Yes, she is.
Why does she think it's a saxophone?
I will be in a relationship. Oh, dear God, throw me back.
In fact, the... And there was a 66-pound catfish caught at Oundle by another woman, Bev Street. The point is that if men had caught these enormous fish, no one would be groping around for reasons as to why men were such good fishermen. Right. The fact that women happen to hold the record is everyone suddenly going, well, there must be some explanation for that. It can't be because they're good at fishing. It must be because they give off a chemical.
Because they're pubes are attracted to fish.
Has anybody ever heard bees having sex?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was one of the worst porn films I ever saw.
There it is, in fact.
They got kicked out of Kew Gardens for that.
The extraordinary thing is that it makes an audible sound. It's a very female-centred society. The women do all the work. Carrie had no change there.
No change.
And the drones, the boys, their sole job is to mate with the Queen, and hardly any of them get a chance to do so. But if you manage to mate with the Queen, once you have done so, your phallus ejaculates from your body. The whole thing tears off with an audible pop.
I think most blokes would think that's worth it.
Well, it actually plugs up the vagina. That's the whole point, is it stops the semen coming back out again. So all of the drones want to mate with the Queen, but only a very few of them are able to do so.
It's like Beyonce and Jay-Z. So if many want Queen Bee, she chooses one who lets her down, and she steals his phallus and makes an album about it.
She has sex with multiple drones.
Beyonce,
not Beyonce.
What does she do with all the spare?
The spare? They get ejected eventually. She gets rid of them.
That must be intimidating. Yeah. You go in to see the Queen, and they're all on a shelf.
It's a dartboard. Don't open the door!
Well, maybe it's the bee that's just had sex with her. He walks out like that and there's a big long queue, and then his cock just hits him on the back of the head.
Oh, sorry.
But how long do you think they have sex for?
I'm thinking if you knew that was going to happen, you'd be making it last as long as possible.
It's anywhere between 10 and 80 minutes.
OK.
And sometimes while they're flying, which must be... That, like, must be, you know...
Is that like the Mile High Club for bees? Yeah. Woo-hoo! This is better than I imagined! Oh, no!
Getting up. What gets you up in the morning? Bizarre picture to choose, but,
I'm a writer. I mean, getting up in the morning isn't really part of my job.
I used to leave the World Service on overnight, but just very quiet on the radio at the side, and so I thought I'd wake up sort of quite naturally. But I was listening to Radio 4 on the way to work the next day, and I heard the news on the radio, and I thought, I dreamed this. For 2 days, I thought I was psychic. Because I'd been dreaming what I was listening to on the World Service. I thought, oh, my God, I've got the powers.
Are there ones you know of, did you ever use as a child when, if you didn't have an alarm clock?
There was the old wivesy one. Bang your head on the pillow the number of times
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
And you would wake up.
Wake up at 6.
Yeah.
With concussion.
Do you not? Have you not heard that?
Not tried that.
You maybe have to have been at a boarding school. But we used to, like, if you were, we were doing a raid on the kitchens or something, we'd say, OK, we'll get up at 3 and we'll go down to the kitchens because they had these big blocks of catering jelly and you'd eat the blocks of jelly.
Left out specially for the ones who are going to raid the kitchen?
Yeah. Probably.
The kids have been raiding the kitchen again, better leave some jelly out.
But we would go bang, 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 like that, 3, and you'd wake up at 3. And it seemed to work. We were convinced it did work. Sleep researchers say that it doesn't. You just wake up a lot because you're not sleeping, and you look at your watch, and then you only remember the one that works.
You've got a tremendous headache,
by the way. Yes, you've got a headache, the later you want to sleep. You say you don't get up early, but are you a night owl? Do you work later?
No, I can get up early, but I have to.
Yeah. So it's reckoned that 20% of people are genuinely, you know, it is a difficulty for them because they are... They are larks or owls, as you might say. They are early or late, and that's to say they fall asleep at dinner parties if they're a lark, and they just can't get up if they're an owl.
Teenagers are owls, aren't they?
Young children are larks, and teenagers are owls. And then very old people tend to get back to being larks again and rise very early.
But it's very irritating. If people do get up very early, they will justify that by saying, best part of the day, best part of the day. It's not, it's just part of the day. I see
when
another bit
open.
Of the day.
There are things that happen early in the morning that are different if you've stayed up for them than if you've woken up to them. Like it's 3 or 4 in the morning and you're having an all-nighter and you hear the bim and you feel guilty and you hate the fact the morning's come. If you wake up to it, you think, yes. Belongs to me. It's a big difference, isn't it?
I used to live in a house in Herne Hill and I had the room at the front and there was one bin man who thought he could sing and at 6 in the morning he would come and he would sing Don't Cry For Me, Argentina. But he could never get the last note. So he'd go, Don't Cry For Me, Argentina.
No!
Well, it used to vary morning to morning. And I was that close to insanity because he was, you know, he was my lark, yeah, every
Rex
morning.
Harrison did your bins.
Yeah, two sisters called Argentina, didn't you know?
Name some common Egyptian characters.
Egyptian.
Oh, no, no, no. Oh, yes?
The Eye of Horus.
Chances.
I don't know why the Eye of Horus isn't a common Egyptian character.
Because it's a hieroglyph, and hieroglyphs were only used for special occasions.
Ah.
So they were not common.
Well,
in fact,
I think you'll find that there were many special occasions in Egyptian.
Yes. Obviously. The thing is, a normal everyday form of writing in Egyptian was hieratic. So it's a simplified version. It's a much more cursive version. Oh, there it is.
That's a rarefied klaxon.
Frankly.
Yes.
Victoria, they've set you up there.
Yes, I don't know, yeah. Can only describe it as a trap. So do you have them on Early Connect? Do you not hieroglyphs use them?
Yeah, we do.
Yes.
In our first series, it was Greek letters.
Right.
And people wrote in and said, we like the show, but we find that pretentious. So we began, I think, series 3 with an apology, saying we'd like to say sorry to anyone that's been enjoying the show, but they found the Greek letters a bit pretentious. We've listened. It's your BBC. You reached out. We've heard you. Please choose your Egyptian hieroglyph.
Well, they're for special occasions, you see. Yeah. The thing is that they can have multiple meanings. So sometimes they just represent the thing they're drawing. So it could be a saw of some kind. It could be a tool of some kind. It could be something else. So the nose hieroglyph, for example, means smell or joy or contempt. But no vowels. Again, they're like the only connect thing you have around, don't you, with no vowels. Yeah. There are no vowels in ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs, so we have no idea how it would have sounded. So King Ramses could be King Ramses, we don't know.
But that's impossible because, you know... Well, I suppose you can measure that vowels. Because when it comes to diction, vowels for volume,
right.
Consonants for clarity. As in the exercise that is performed by actors, you repeat the following. Hip bath, lavatory, lavatory, bidet, bidet, douche.
Are these all things you're advertising?
How has the Eurovision Song Contest made Europe a better place?
How has it made it a better place? Yeah. Because it has, as you can see, the dove.
Yeah.
It has brought together the nations of Europe.
Has it? Arse, it's divided east from west. I mean...
It has brought together the nations of Europe on wings of song.
Whether they like it or not.
but you only have to listen to my commentary to realise how much I believe that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
One of the few Eurovision Song Contests I remember incredibly well because the winners are one of the most famous pop groups in the world has ever been. That was ABBA, and that was in the year...
1974, Brighton.
1974, exactly, with the song...
Waterloo.
Waterloo, a great song. But there happened to be a song that Portugal provided that year. They came second from bottom. They only got 3 points.
It was called Paddington.
But it was one of the most important Eurovision songs ever written for an extraordinary political reason.
Are you saying that that was the signal for the Portuguese Revolution?
Yes, I am. It was called A Depois de Adeus, After the Goodbye, sung by Paulo de Carvalho.
I have to tell you that I think you got the year wrong. It was the following year, when it was being held in Sweden, after ABBA had won, that that was the Portuguese Revolution, and they came out with guns with carnations in the barrels
yes,
of the guns.
Yes, because it was called the Carnation Revolution, wasn't it? We yield to you, none knows better than you. But isn't it wonderful? It was that song was used because a man called Salazar, or at least his party, had run Portugal for years and years. He didn't technically style his regime a fascist one, but he certainly gave 3 days national mourning when Hitler died, for example. So yes. I think you can call him right-wing.
He wasn't quite Franco, but he was pretty
He was pretty close. Yeah. Bizarre leader, because he had a stroke. And after his stroke, he was relieved of his command, and a man called Caetano became prime minister, but they never told Salazar. He went to the grave thinking he was still running the country. They just took his power away from him, and he still thought he was running, was signing things, but it was of no importance whatsoever.
Isn't that nice? That's such a lovely way of doing it.
Yeah. That could be a fantastic scheme for so many dictators. They don't get out much. Yeah. All you need is a noise of some crowds playing on a tape outside. Big office, lots of things to sign. Well, I hope when I go mad that someone pretends I'm in charge of a large country and gives me lots of things to sign, rather than just sedates me and sticks me in front of a window.
Got my hands on the American nuclear trigger. Without putting yourselves to too much effort, see if you can tell me what the code is.
Secret trigger code.
The secret trigger code given to every American president between the years of 1960 and 1977.
Well, I think that if you've got to remember it under pressure, and it would be a pressure situation, beginning the end of the world, it's got to be something quite simple.
It's 0000000000. That literally was the code. 4 zeros twice, 8 zeros. 8 zeros. That was the password.
Is that because you're just about, it's the end of the world, and you are going to go, oh, 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 oh.
Did the president, when he's testing this, did he do the chip and pin, you know, that little dance you do when the shopkeeper just looking at you and you kind of go...
You pretend to press.
You do a boogie, because I do it, I just do a cover.
Because you've not noticed polite shopkeepers now do this, which is what they call the penny chews. We just go out there and they do
I think it's pretend to do other numbers than the ones they're doing. Yes.
So you're there with the lovely Debbie McGee going...
Do your number, but while you're doing your number, you say a different number slightly under your breath, so you look like a bit of an idiot.
Well, that's like you're all rubbing your tummy and patting your head. That is clever.
His number's 457.
But because the people I always most hated at school were those who, when they were writing in a test, did that.
Yeah.
As if one cared about what
That's
dribble they wrote.
That's because you're not an idiot.
Oh, no, no. It's such a creepy way of behaving. So I always just do like that, grandly make sure that my number is...
I published mine in The Sun once.
It went quite badly
wrong.
That was very funny.
I couldn't understand it because they were complaining that everybody's bank details had been left on a train by a civil servant or somebody, and I thought, well, that doesn't make any difference because all they can do is make a deposit. So I published my number. There you go, there's my bank account number. What are you going to do with that? And the Diabetic Society helped themselves to 500 quid.
Would anyone like some koala soup?
Jimmy. Presumably a hungry koala.
Of course, it would be a hungry koala. It would be a hungry baby koala. Because koalas are the only animals to make what is called a soup or pap.
What, in a bowl?
They make it in the bowl of their body and it comes out of their
Mouth
ears. Bottom, yes, their ass. You get a point for knowing ass, yes. Thank very good.
They make soup with their ass.
They make a soup for their young with their ass.
That's careless parenting, isn't it?
It was.
I just quite like to ask, why haven't they had that on the Bush Tucker trial in Ireland?
A very good question.
I bring a koala out and hold it over you.
It does.
Horrible. Your koala ship.
It does a horrible new meaning to right. Waiter, there's a hair in my suit.
They're not koala bears, they're not bears.
Well done, they're not bears,
they're
are they?
They're marsupials.
Yes, what are they most closely related to?
Kangaroos,
the fish.
Other marsupials.
A wombat, in fact.
A wombat.
They're wombats,
brothers and sisters.
Wombats don't have soup, they have cubical feces.
Do they?
Oddly, yes. Little dice.
Cubicular?
Cubicle.
He can't get that leaf down, that he's been chewing it for 10 minutes.
Well, no, isn't that because he's eating the leaves of the eucalyptus tree?
He is, indeed.
Which acts as a powerful hallucinogen on the koala. Mm. So a lot of the time, they're just singing, yeah, whoa. What did I come up here for?
Got the idea of
well, it's an analgesic rather than a hallucinogen.
I've always got those two mixed up, you know.
It's sort of numb, a painkiller.
It's poisonous.
Yes. Yeah.
They have an incredibly long intestine, about a mile long, to digest all that poison that would kill a human.
Yes, what it is, it's really quite interesting, is, and that's what we're here for, be quite interesting, they can tell, which scientists can't, the age of a eucalyptus leaf. It has to be between a year and 18 months. If it's any younger, it has no value whatsoever to them. No,
they sleep for 20 to 22 hours a
22
day.
22 hours a day? I've got to give you 2 points for that. You're absolutely right.
I won a night out with a koala. Yeah, when we were out all night. We went to a restaurant and to a club.
What do you have? Soup of the day?
What did they drink? What did your koala drink?
Becks.
Time for some refreshment. Here we go. Let's have you pass that there to Sarah, if you would, Alan. Oh, there you go. There's one for you, Jack. You pass one to Adam.
Yep.
Thank you very much. I'll have one myself. And there's one for you, Alan. There you go. Mmm. Mmm.
You do this.
You've done this before.
So, make it upright first.
Mm. All right. Come on, will you talk to it? Come here, you. No. Oh, you look lovely. You're so huge. I don't think I'm going to be able to manage it. Oh, there you are. Yes.
Oh, what do you think these were once used for?
Useful, or particularly these ones on sticks?
Well, not ones on sticks.
Waving in tiny aeroplanes?
Is it like what Gwyneth Paltrow gives her kids?
Well, they probably are.
You see, dark.
Seeing in the dark, well, you're in the right era. When was it said that carrots could help you see in the dark?
At night.
In which period of history was it made known to people this idea, which is not really true?
The Dark Ages.
Not the Dark Ages.
Maybe people discovered vitamins.
Yeah.
Well, that wasn't until the beginning of the 20th century.
Because vitamin A is the key, helps your eyes, doesn't it?
Vitamin A does help your eyes.
So enough... it must have been around about then.
Well, it was really...
That's been so hard being a rabbit. I never get any talking done.
They just stay in the hut.
I've got a mouth with a bloody carrot.
The problem was, in the Second World War, we would run out of... Put it away.
Concentrate, Tim.
Is that what I need to do?
It looked like the world's worst burlesque dance.
So, in the Second World War, there was a very great shortage of sugar, and there was a big surplus of carrots, and so they put it about that carrots helped you see in the dark.
Oh, did they?
I really love carrots,
So they made sort of ice creams, as it were, out of carrots to try and make them attractive to children. There is a certain amount of sugar in them. As you could probably tell, they tasted a little sweet, didn't they?
Yeah, it was lovely.
And there was a group captain, John Cunningham, who was responsible for a very daring night raid over Germany, and they gave it out that what allowed him to do it was the fact that he ate carrots. In fact, what they were really doing was disguising the fact that they had onboard aircraft radar. They had radar on board. They didn't want the Germans to know. The Germans knew we had ground radar, not that we had radar on board.
So they sold the carrot story to the Germans as well?
That was the idea, both to get children to eat their carrots and maybe to get the Germans to believe that it was carrots that allowed our bombers to see over those.
Wouldn't it have been more beneficial if they'd said the reason our pilots are so good at seeing at night is because they eat slightly undercooked chicken?
You should have been working in British intelligence. You're just the kind of chap we need, Whitehall. Which of the following M places is made up? There they are. Misak Setafet. The Mountains of Kong. Made up Arura. Merv. Yes, Sammy.
I'm going to say made up Arura only because it has made up literally in its name.
There's a logic there, and but you're new to QI, and I'd like to be merciful, but I'm not going to.
All right, fair enough.
In a sense, all names are made up, aren't they?
To the logically ruthless world of David Dixon. You sound like that, I'm sorry. But no, of course you're right. Yeah. You're right. But which one is not existing? But we have.
The Mountains of Kong sounds like it's from fiction.
That sounds totally made up. Mountains of Kong?
You're right. You're sounds right. Like though it was made up in a way that was utterly convincing for 100 years.
It's not like something from Flash Gordon or something like that.
No, it's earlier than that. It was a cartographer who was a highly respected figure who was just imagining them. It was a chain of mountains all the way across Africa, below the Sahara and before what you might call darkest Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, as we'd now say. And this, right up to 1895, this was in atlases. He was called James Rennell, and he was a very respected figure. And he
until someone went skiing in the Mountains of Kong.
The effect of it was that the effect of it was that nobody dreamt or thought of passing this barrier and going through to the rest of Africa.
Yeah,
They had obviously navigated the coast. There was the slave routes, which were all the way further down. But everyone thought that from the north you couldn't get through.
Did he? What did he do? Spill something on the map?
That's quite bollocks. I'll call it the Mountains.
But who gets to name? Who gets the honour of naming a thing? If you chance upon it, can you call it?
Yeah.
Kong Mountains or Jimmy Hill, or
you name it in the case
or,
of David Livingstone, you call it Lake Victoria after your dear queen and all that sort of thing.
It's difficult to name it after yourself, isn't it?
Yeah,
you have to name it after someone. I'd say the thing to do as an explorer would be to get there and then ask your assistant explorer if they can think of a name. While reminding them how they got that job.
Yes. Scoot round now. Some handy household hints that I want you to help me with. Joe, that's a good way to create the impression that you've cleaned the house when you haven't.
Just lock the door and kill everyone.
This is to create that awful word, freshness.
Open the window?
Well, you'd think, frankly, that
drink
is...
Drink some lavender water and have a piss.
Every time you get a minicab home, nick the little tree off of his mirror.
I'm no fan of this tip, and it only works in the autumn and winter months. Oh. You spray or apply furniture polish to a radiator, and it fills the room with the smell of furniture polish. These hints are either from a book called Trade Secrets by Catherine Lapworth and Alexandra Fraser, or from Super Hints by the lady...
I know those two.
Do you know...
The slags, the pair of them.
What do you know? There's a book called Super Hints by the Lady Waddington.
Yeah, I know her.
Do you know the Lady Waddington?
She's a bitch. So, you know, let's get on to more practical.
All right, OK, Jessica, we'll try this one. How would you treat silk like spaghetti and vice versa?
What, store it in a jar?
There's something you can do to each of them.
Throw it against the wall, see if it sticks.
Ah! But what sort of wall?
Kitchen.
A kitchen wall, you...
Take it round
the house and yeah. find it.
Can I come in? What if I come in?
Your dinner's ready.
Whereas in the case of silk, why would you throw silk against the wall?
Well, having a passion, you know. Yeah.
You'd throw silk against the brick wall. It would stick if it...
If it was silk.
If it were silk, exactly. It's right. a test to see if it's not polyester or crimplin or something.
But it's ruined then, once you've peeled it off again.
Well, it doesn't stick like spaghetti. It just catches and you just pull it off.
Took the paint off my kitchen wall, the spaghetti.
Yes, but the silk wouldn't take anything off your brick wall. That's all vice versa.
Nonetheless, Brenda wouldn't chance it now. No. If she saw any silk stuck on the wall, she'd leave it.
Used as a fainting goat.
Everything I do. I have heard of them because I've seen the television version of this. It's a breed or a variety of goat which falls over rather suddenly.
When it's nervous.
I think I can only think of one use for it. If you were to dramatise some 19th century novels, but using animals, when the heroine had to swoon, like that, you would cast the goat to do that.
You
so
would.
That would be an immediate and a practical use for a fainting goat. But they're just like a race of goat. I don't know, like an Anglo-Nubian only. These are fainting race. Goats. They're in America, and that's the limit of my knowledge.
Well, if they faint when they're nervous, then they would presumably alert you to danger. On the perimeter of your farm. Perhaps Nazis were rearing up over the hillock.
Or wolves attacking or something like that. Or
well,
dogs
yeah,
or
wolves.
Next door neighbor.
They're extraordinary. They're called the Tennessee or myotonic goat. You keep them with a flock of sheep. And when the wolf comes, the poor goat, whenever it gets a fright, goes stiff as a board and just goes over like that. So the sheep all escape. And the goat gets eaten because the goat is
there
less valuable
yes.
than the sheep. So it's not that it warns the sheep. It sort of warns the sheep, but
it's not much of a long life for the goat.
So it takes one for the team.
It takes one for the team. Takes the bullet.
So they actually do faint with fear. Do they do that as they go down?
Yeah.
It's called myotonia congenita, and it occurs in several species, including humans. It only lasts about 10 seconds. It goes as stiff as a board, then it returns to normal. Apparently, it's painless, according to humans who suffer from it, at least. Apparently, the older and more experienced fainting goats lean against things to stop themselves falling.
Somebody hold me up. It must be quite hard to become an older fainting goat, though, because the wolves are generally biting your throat
that
out.
That is the problem.
Yes.
But fainting goats protect your flock by swooning and being eaten by wolves, while the sheep make good their escape.
Name the greatest Wimbledon champion of all time.
Mm. Andy Murray.
I think I would have said Sampras.
Sorry. Sampras?
Great Uncle Bulgaria. Is it a croquet player? Oh.
Yes! Oh, it is a croquet player. Oh, absolutely right. Professor Bernard Neal is the greatest Wimbledon champion of all time. He won the croquet championships 38 times. So if you think about it, Navratilova, Wimbledon singles 9 times. He won 38 times. He only took the sport up at the age of 40. Between 1963 and 2002, he won 37 titles out of a possible 40.
Smacks of a drug cheat, that.
What do you have to press on the red button to get coverage of the croquet?
Got a bit of croquet here, so... Alan, to what colour do you want to be? Do you want to be red or blue or...?
Black.
Black, here we go.
Can I be the iron?
Which way are you going to go? You're going to go right, right?
Pleased me so much. It went miles.
It would be under someone's feet.
Croquet, it was an Olympic sport.
It should be still.
It was dropped after 1900 because only one person turned up to watch. So. But the reason it's interesting is because the very first women to take part in the Olympics took part as part of the French croquet team. So there were 7 men and 3 women. And it was thought to be rather racy because it was a game where men and women played on equal footing. There's a wonderful quote from the American Christian Review in 1878, said croquet would lead to moral decline in American women and consequences would include absence from church, immoral conduct, and eventually ruin.
True, though. That's a very pessimistic view.
Anybody know the connection between croquet and Pall Mall, the great street in London.
Oh, they played croquet upon it?
Yes, they did. It is, in fact, where croquet comes from. An Italian game, 17th century game, called Pall Mall. And both Pall Mall and the Mall were designed specifically to play this game. They whacked the ball up the course and then they had to shoot a ball through a suspended hoop at the end, and that's where we begin
that's
to get
much
croquet
more like
from.
Quidditch. The people who play actual Quidditch near where I live, they run around with broomsticks between their legs. None of them can fly.
That is what leads inevitably to ruin.
Yes. Now, identify the world's biggest gas bag.
Oh, Lord. John McCruick. That's a very good answer. An actual bag of actual gas.
That would probably be the best way to go, without hinting too much.
Presume something like the Hindenburg, an airship, an enormous airship.
Perhaps. Well, kind of like an airship, yes, though, in fact, even bigger. This is the biggest such device ever constructed
by man.
Is
it the one that Bruce Dickinson from Iron Maiden is involved with?
How extraordinary you are. No. But I'm very impressed that you should know of that.
Now, I met him about 5 years ago. He said he was doing it, invested a huge amount of money, and it's about 200 feet, like 300 feet long or something. It's absolutely enormous. There's pictures of it. It looks like an arse, the way it's
that's
built.
It. It does. There it is, like an arse.
But it's in a hangar that's so big it has its own climate.
Yes.
Has clouds and all sorts of
things. Why, oh, why, oh, why?
Did he do it? Well, because for commercial reasons.
Yeah. It's like it goes 100 miles per hour.
Yeah, it's like properly quite impressive.
Have they sorted out the whole, you know, Hindenburg
no,
fiery death
No, they decided
element.
Not to worry about it.
It can carry 50 tonnes. It can stay in the air for 3.5 weeks. But the difference between that and the Hindenburg is, do you know?
Not full of hydrogen,
well,
I take it.
Well, the Hindenburg and the earlier airships were full of hydrogen, which is incredibly flammable. not just incredibly or intensely, but incredibly.
Well, that's which is why it blew up.
That's why it blew up, because it was incredibly flammable.
What have I told you about reading Jabberwocky before you present?
It's incredibly dangerous.
So, yes, that was a really good interruption.
Is this a naturally occurring gas bag?
No, it isn't. It is the biggest ever bag of gas created by humankind.
Does it have a purpose? So it has a purpose other than storing the gas?
It had a purpose in as much as it broke three records, which are better remembered than this record. What are the three records you might think of in terms of a balloon?
Height, distance,
yes.
Height, number
distance,
of deaths.
There were no deaths. There were no deaths in this case.
Is it loudest pop?
Not
most excited child.
Who jumped out of a really high balloon?
Oh, Baumgartner.
Yeah.
Felix Baumgartner is the right answer. This is the So Felix Baumgartner, there he is. He fell from a greater height than anyone has ever fallen.
Right.
He achieved a greater speed than anyone has fallen, which made him the first man ever to what?
Break the sound barrier.
Break the sound barrier unaided. And it was the highest balloon ascent ever. Those are three records. The highest balloon ascent, biggest free fall.
Do you know what else it was, Stephen?
What's that?
It was incredibly dangerous.
But it was the largest balloon ever constructed. And let's have a look at how big it was. It was bigoted.
Whoa.
It was bigoted than the Statue of Liberty.
It was more bigoted more than bigoted. The Statue of Liberty.
What is the matter?
What is going on? Get rid of this one, get another one in.
Secretaries, this doesn't lead me to wonder, why was Squirrel Nutkin such a lying bastard?
I should know this, because I've been to the Beatrix Potter Museum.
Have you? So where's it, the Lake District somewhere?
Yes. It's quite good. If you like Beatrix Potter, it's amazing.
Yeah. So we've been talking about lying, we've been talking about faking orgasms.
Is it a colour? Is it
because he was ginger?
Well, Squirrel Nutkin, as you rightly point out, was a red squirrel, but most other squirrels tend to pretend that they buried their food to trick potential thieves. They dig a hole, they pretend to put a nut inside and cover it up very quickly. All the time, the nut is actually still in their mouth. And then they also recache, so they bury nuts and then they return to them soon afterwards, dig them up and bury them somewhere else. And they sometimes do this 5 times with the same stash. But they did a study in 2008. Almost a quarter of all squirrel burials, that's of food at some sites, not of each other, were faked.
It's too late. You said squirrel burials. So
they're gorgeous, but they're like.
Yeah. They're mainly unmarked, but you do see little headstones occasionally.
But here's the thing. There has been a debate since at least 1884, and it rages on, whether squirrels remember where they hide their nuts or whether they just hide as many as they can and then return to a likely place.
Define rages.
Well, there have been studies since 1881. There was one in 1991, a study done at Princeton.
Two.
So they don't have a conclusion.
No. The thing is, it rages on. Rages on. There was a fantastic story about a squirrel in 2015. A squirrel got locked into the bar of Honeybourne Railway Club in Worcestershire for the day. Okay. It got drunk and caused £300 worth of damage. So the club secretary, a guy called Sam Bolter, he said that all he could find was broken glass and bottles knocked off shelves. There was beer all over the floor, there was money and straws scattered everywhere, and he found the culprit hiding behind a box of crisps, looking, he said, unsteady and worse for wear.
What kind of creature has a terrible memory? Short memory.
My dad can't remember anything. I went round to see him the other day and he looked at me like that.
Doesn't everybody?
I went, hi, Dad. He went, oh.
My neighbour's dog doesn't remember when I kick it, because I do it. No, loads of times, he still comes up to me. Oh. I'll kick it really hard in the face.
Goldfish!
A goldfish! With my boot.
Oh, not goldfish. No, there is...
3-second memory.
Well, there is this fallacy that goldfish have a 3-second memory. It is a fallacy. They've done tests.
Oh, they have.
They have. A man from Plymouth University did wonderful tests.
Said to the goldfish what happened on EastEnders last night. And he remembered most of it.
Two things. One, there isn't a Plymouth University. That's made up. And two, they can't remember anything.
Yeah, it's a sweet shop with a copy of The Times in it, isn't it?
Dr. Phil G of the University of Plymouth's psychological
department. Is he a rapper?
He does sound like that, Dr. Phil G. He trained them to press levers. And they could even tell time, because he would have the lever work just for an hour in the day, and they would come and press at the right time to deliver food. And they knew exactly where it was, and they would come back to it.
And how come they can't tell that the deep-sea diver is 3 times as big as the castle? Damn smart.
Well, it seems they have pretty good memories, as a matter of fact. What's more, they're not gold. Put them back in the wild, they go to brown and other different colours.
Actually, not true, because I've got two in a pond. They've been there 5 years, they're still orange. So...
No, in the wildy, wildy, wildy. But if you're in captivity and
where's
for some reason...
Where's the wildy, wildy, wildy? I'd like to go there.
Technical term.
The Norfolk.
So what can't remember anything, then? I bet a koala can't remember much. Wakes up... Oh.
I bet a pig on fire can't remember much.
I had a strange experience when I was in Australia recently, and I went to a day out to the zoo, and they give you a koala to hold, and you have a photograph taken of it. And koalas are very lazy animals. They don't exactly work out. You know what I mean? They haven't got firm buttocks or anything. And I had one in my hand, and it kind of just slipped. And before I knew it, I actually had a sort of koala's buttocks. It was actually slipped onto my finger. And it just sort of slid on, and there's... On the photograph, because they take a photograph of you, you're supposed to say, hold a koala. And the koala goes. The worst thing was, they wanted it back. And I said, well, can I hold it for a bit longer? And I was trying to get the finger out. And I said, can I take it away?
The list of charges is beginning to add up.
During the First World War, seagulls were trained to search out German submarines and then crap on their periscopes. Pretty clear message. But what is this camel behind me trying to tell you here? What's going on?
Oh, dear.
That's a very disgusted audience, though. They don't like what they see.
Did he say Jeremy Carl's on in a minute?
Do you know, what are we looking at there?
I presume it's a tongue, is it? But is it a sausage?
It's not his tongue, amazingly.
Is it his stomach?
It's his palate. It can blow part of his soft palate out. It's called the palatinus diverticulus. It's known as a gullet, and it's used as, again, we've been discussing, it's used in mating. It's in, used to attract females.
Oh, you really sexy beast, you.
Yeah, it's a heck of a thought, isn't
not
it?
Not working for me.
It appears to be sticking out its tongue. The camels with the most testosterone have the biggest gullet.
That's what they tell you.
Yeah.
it's like that nonsense about bald men being full of testosterone, isn't it?
Yeah, I know, bless. But, no, the size of... What? Well, hey.
Phil's not insulted, because he doesn't know. Phil doesn't know he's bald.
I don't know.
Oh, what do you mean, he's convinced he's got a big, thick, luscious head of hair. Well, down my back there is.
Well, I've got that.
Anyway, they do that. They blow out their gullet and they make a bloop, bloop, bloop noise, apparently.
Yeah, bloop, bloop, bloop. That's the best they've come up with after all these years.
In Saudi Arabia and other countries, they often cut the gullet out. Why would they do that? Do you know why?
To stop it? They cut it out?
It's so they breathe better for camel racing.
Oh, camel racing.
Yeah. Actually, in Saudi Arabia, they import camels from...
Kent.
Yeah. You set them up so well, Steve.
Comes from Kent. No, not from Kent.
From Hertfordshire.
Not from... Let's disabuse ourselves. Australia is the right answer, yes. Thank you. But why would they import them? What do they need them for?
They're very good at cricket, the Australian one.
The Australian camels are actually much fitter than the...
Oh, look, we like sports.
Yeah.
It's a big outdoors.
No, they don't. They don't. No, they don't use them to race. They don't use them for transport. They use the camels they import for
food.
Freedom. Food for meat. They, camel meat.
They eat them. They tell them they're going to have a lovely life as a camel race. You'll love it over there, mate. Away you go. Good luck. Give us a call when you've won your first race.
How did the Danish government convince its citizens to multiply? This is one of my Randy Scandies.
You mean? Actually...
I do mean that.
Were there financial incentives?
There were incentives.
We all need incentives anyway, don't we?
What, to procreate?
Yeah. Or just, you know, the bit before that as well.
Right. I'm fine, but OK.
incentivise me!
So I can narrow it down. It's actually a place called Tisted, which is in Jutland, so the mainland, the bit that sticks up from Germany. So what happened in 2015, the local authorities were going to close down the local school, and everybody was very upset in the local area. So they struck a deal that the people would procreate as much as possible if they kept the school and the leisure facilities open. Nothing says, I'm bringing sexy back like a council memo.
Did they all have to have kids?
Well, as many as possible, so they were encouraged to have kids. I have to say, it's a lovely place, Tista. Not a lot to do. Number three on their own website of things to do in the area is visit the candle shop.
Sexy candles for around the bath.
There's been lots of times before. Britain has had its own panics about falling populations because of the war and contraception and so on. So, in 1921, the Daily Express ran a competition to find Britain's largest family, and the News of the World offered a free tea tray to any mother. Any mother who gave birth to her 10th child. Don't want your bloody tea tray, I'll take your head off with it. And the French still give medals for having large families. That's still a thing, the Médaille de la Famille Française. How many kids for bronze? What do you reckon?
Six.
4 to 5. Silver, you get 6 to 7. Gold, 8+.
I thought you said 45 for a second.
There's so much wrong with that picture. I can't begin.
Go on.
Why are they creating a human bench for their two children?
That is worrying.
Have they glued their heads together? Maybe they're ventriloquists and that's how they hold their children. Just used to holding people like that.
What's the best way to ensure that your family never forgets you after you're gone?
Oh. Haunting.
Haunting is a good way, yeah.
Insists on being buried in an exact replica of your house. Yes. That they have to pay for and therefore sell the house they live in to...
You're still angry, aren't
you? Finance it, yeah.
Being stuffed.
Well, yes, being stuffed. Now,
deserved in some way.
There's a very extreme example
Leaning
of that.
On the mantelpiece.
Just slightly in front of the television so they can't see.
There was an artist called Hananucha Masakichi.
Oh, yeah.
Have you heard of him? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's bloody good.
He's excellent.
He's Japanese, and in the mid-1880s, he was diagnosed with tuberculosis and knew he was going to die, so he made a statue of himself so lifelike and so realistic. When he stood next to it, people couldn't tell which was which, apparently. He handcrafted glass eyes and then bored a tiny individual hole for every pore of his body and then took the hairs from every pore of his own body and put them into the other pores. He pulled out all his own fingernails and put them in like that, yeah? His toenails and his teeth, right? Now, obviously, this is a replica because it's quite shiny and obviously not anything like a real person.
Can you imagine if he'd done all that and someone had gone, actually, it doesn't look that much like you, and you're left with
no teeth, yeah. No nails.
Imagine he'd done it, taking his eyes out at an early stage and realised what a stupid mistake that was. Damn.
But it found its way, the original, to Robert Ripley's auditorium. Oh, in Los Angeles, but unfortunately, it was injured in an earthquake in 96 and it's currently awaiting restoration. There are other things you can do. What about letting your family see you disintegrate, see you in your coffin? Have a camera.
Have a camera in your coffin?
A webcam, no. Yeah. There is a Seattle-based company called SeeMeRot.com. I'm not making it up. And they have a light and they have a webcam and you can watch your loved one basically rot. There you go.
When you say the only problem I've got with that is loved one.
Yeah. Their slogan, being dead and buried doesn't mean you can't have friends over.
But it's buried underneath. Imagine if you were watching the webcam, just watching and watching and watching, and then suddenly it went. You would be so freaked out by that, wouldn't you?
Something less interesting than watching paint dry.
Watching dried paint?
It's already dry. Yes, that's a good point.
I mean, is it actually interesting then? Is something going on in your head?
It's scientifically interesting. So this is another one of those things where science does something that you think, why are you doing that? And it turns out actually to be quite useful. These are researchers at the University of Surrey, and what they discovered that is as paint dries, small particles, it's like they team up and they push away larger ones. And here is the practical application, which from Australia you'll appreciate. When you are developing sun cream, if you can get the active ingredient pushed to the bottom, the bit that sticks to the skin, and the sun-blocking particles pushed to the top, that makes for better sun cream. And they did that by analysing how paint dries.
Yeah. They should try clothes in a hat.
Yeah, that would be a more sensible way. You think
then a roof and just wait till...
Till night.
Later in the day.
A filmmaker called Charlie Lyon, and in 2016 he crowdfunded a film called Paint Drying, and it consists entirely of white paint drying on a brick wall for over 10 hours. So it is the law in this country you cannot show a film unless the British Board of Film Classification has had a look at it. It costs £7.09 per minute to get them to classify your film. So he crowdfunded it and he made a film that was as long as the money he had available. He managed to raise £5,963 and he made a film about this brick wall with paint drying that is 607 minutes long, which the British Board of Film Classification had to watch. You'd like to see it as a U classification, just in case.
He should have just flashed up some porn in the last second.
Yeah. More like a murder, like just blood at the very end. But it is an offence for cinemas to show films with an age restriction to children.
We'd like to see the paint drying film, please.
As many uses for a pig as you can.
Bacon.
Bacon is one.
Truffle snaffling.
Medicine stuff, medicine cases for tablets and...
Oh, for women in pregnancy, doesn't it bring on for inducing pregnancy?
It does if one hormones. Runs through your front row.
Absolutely staggering what you can get out of a
yogurt.
Pig.
Yes, I have a list. Christian Meindertsma wrote a book called Pig 05049, which is an anonymous pig, and beyond the obvious foodstuffs, she found different parts of this animal offered the following pork derivatives. From the skin alone, safety gloves, cosmetic surgery, collagen, comes from pig skin, energy bars, which also have collagen in, low-fat butter, chewing gum, X-ray film, drug capsules, bread, flour improver made from pig hair, would you believe? Flour, I know. The skin is also used for tattoo practice. And ballistic gelatin. That's just the skin, and then there's the internal organs, pet food, tambourine skins are made from a pig's bladder. Your old tambourine.
I knew those folkies were evil. Yeah.
There are many thousands of people who are alive because of a pig's valve from their heart. From the bones, cheap wine corks, would you believe? Stabilizing propellant and bullet making, inkjet paper, concrete, match heads, bone china, train brakes, yoghurt, which you correctly mentioned.
What's a train brake? Like, where you stopping a train. For the
weekend.
For
stopping it.
Oh. He's basically a trotter out. He just leans forward.
Fabric softener. Who knew? Beer, wine, ice cream. From the fat, biodiesel, soap, shampoos, crayons. From the blood, cigarette filters, amazingly. Toothpaste. And also paintbrushes. Chemical weapons testing. The ears are used in chemical weapons testing. Don't ask me why. I should hasten to add that not all toothpaste and not all yoghurt contain it. But if you are a Muslim or Jewish, you've got a hell of a problem discovering what's got pig in it.
You have your work cut out.
You have your work cut out like a silhouettist. According to Bloomberg, there are 42 major areas of manufacturing that entirely rely on pork products. It's quite astonishing what that one animal can do. And it's the only farmyard animal, if you discount truffle hunting, that is only useful when dead. It has no
use. You say that. You've never gambled with a pig.
Oh, come I know. They're
terrible gamblers. Poker, blackjack.
But obviously ducks and geese and hens lay eggs and goats give milk and cows give milk and sheep
companionship?
Companionship. Love. I know they do offer those.
My brother's got a pig, and that's very true of that one.
Yeah, they are very endearing animals.
Tell him to be careful, though, because I knew a farmer that had a heart attack while he was feeding his pigs and they ate him.
Oh, yes. Well, I'm afraid.
You don't want to get into a pen with one that's approaching sexual maturity, as I know to my cost.
Really?
Yeah. It's basically like
how are the piglets?
They've got names, Alan. It's
Porky
like
and Perkins.
Pinky and Perkins. It's scary. It's like a pork piano, because they breed pigs very long now, because everyone likes chops.
That's right.
So you get incredibly long
pigs.
With
a huge row of udders, you can see on the sour country.
And, just runs at you in a sort of matey way.
This was obviously the boar, the male.
Yes,
she
wasn't interested.
No, she wasn't.
Although I was trying to catch her eye.
Priests for the moment, who was the mad monk of Russia?
Rasputin
is... Oh.
I thought I'd take that for
the team. Take the team. Thank you, Kelly.
Why was it not him?
Well, because he was the lover of the Russian queen.
Is that what you're basing all your knowledge of history?
He was a cat that really was gone.
Yes. Why was he not the mad monk of Russia?
He wasn't mad and he wasn't a monk.
He wasn't a monk, the truth of it. He was never a monk. The guy who referred to himself as the mad monk was a one-time friend of Rasputin's. He was called Sergei Trufanov, also known as Ilya Dor. There he is. And he wrote his memoirs. They were published in New York in 1918, and he published them as The Mad Monk of Russia. And that book is one of the primary sources that we have for the life of Rasputin. So the mad monk is the less famous Ilya Dor and not Rasputin, but because we know so much about Rasputin from this book, The Mad Monk of Russia, that is why we associate him. Yeah. I think everybody knows that. Rasputin was a faith healer, and he parlayed his claim to be able to help the son of the Tsar into a position of tremendous influence in the Russian imperial court. I mean, Rasputin himself, unbelievably poorly educated. His diary, he misspells the word diary.
So you think it's all about milk?
Yeah, possibly. He claimed that by sleeping with women, he could take on their sins and help them find the grace
of God. I've tried that. I'll take your sins on.
Yeah.
There's a theory, a sort of rogue theory about Putin being the reincarnation of Rasputin. And there was a thing that was about, they took some of Putin's pubic hair and then they took some of Rasputin's residual testicular fluid, and the DNA was exactly the same.
So, I'm struggling with the whole of that story.
I do like the phrase residual testicular fluid.
I'm getting to need...
Should we use that again? I'm not sure. Can I have a vodka and residual testicular fluid, please?
So we're going to need an unwashed sheet of some kind.
Yeah, Putin left his pubic hairs everywhere, isn't it?
They scraped it off the back of a tiger.
So the circumstances of Rasputin's death, I mean, they are stuff of legend, but what is beyond dispute is that the leader of the assassins, Prince Felix Yusupov, was a member of the Bullingdon Club while he was an undergraduate at Oxford. And, in fact, Yusupov, that's him and his wife, Irina, they are the reason why films today carry... You know, there's a statement on films that says any similarity to any living person is entirely coincidental. He and his wife sued MGM over a film called Rasputin and the Empress... produced in 1932, and they won substantial compensation. This is a wonderful story, which I really like, because it sort of makes people more human when you look at their story. Rasputin was actually married and he had three kids, and one of his kids, Maria, she, after the revolution, she emigrated to the United States, and she worked in a circus where she used to every night do a mime of her father's death. She then graduated to becoming a lion tamer. Unfortunately, her career in the circus was cut short when she was mauled by a bear. What are the chances you're working as a lion tamer?
It must have happened during dinner.
Interestingly, she billed herself as the daughter of the mad monk, so it clearly had become a phrase that people used. And she went on in the Second World War to work as a riveter in the shipyards in California. She died in 1977. The mad monk of Russia wasn't Rasputin, it was some bloke you've never heard of.
Can you tell me about bamboo?
Ahoy!
You've attracted someone else on the dark side.
In Hong Kong, and probably elsewhere in Southeast Asia, they use bamboo as scaffolding.
That's right. You're quite right.
It's incredibly lightweight, incredibly, extraordinarily strong, and they use it over vast buildings.
You're right. It has a tensile strength greater than steel. In fact, over 5,000 uses of bamboo have been recorded, including desalination uses,
Tarzan
diesel
uses
fuel.
It for swimming away from people.
Exactly right. Yes, breathing in the water. As a cane to give people a damn good thrashing.
Have you been cane, bamboo cane?
Certainly. In prep school, I was caned almost daily.
Two uses of bamboo. That is just biased.
Never did me any harm.
Are we going through all 5,000 uses?
No, we're not.
One, two, three,
grows incredibly fast. Some species grow up to 4 foot a day. You can actually watch it grow. Quite astonishing. It was used as a torture by the Chinese.
4 foot a day?
Yes.
A torture in the sense that they would make someone sit on it while
And then it would grow up.
It would be a torture, yes.
Tie you down over a bamboo cane and it would grow into you.
Yes. But what is bamboo? What sort
it's
of...
It's a plant.
What sort of
which
plant?
Which is used for growing
sort of
runner beans, feeding
what class
animals.
Of plant?
Tree.
Tree. Bark.
No, it's a grass.
Wood grass. It's a grass. Type of a grass.
It is a type of a grass. Well done. They flower. Some of them flower and, you know, takes them 120 years.
Bill used to have a cactus.
Yep.
Huge cactus.
Yes.
Huge cactus thing that was all knobbly. Yeah. And it flowered, how often? Once every 25
once
years?
Once every 25
and
years.
And he only had it 2 weeks and it flowered.
Yeah. Oh, you are a blessed man.
I know. We took it. We didn't take it off an old couple. We bought it off an old couple.
You left them laying at the passage.
Quick, get away. They're coming round. Quick,
you bastards. It's going to flower in a minute.
We've waited 23 years.
It is strange, though, when you look at that, because we were talking about it earlier, that, you know, shrimp, it is an insect, but we quite happily eat that.
Yes.
Pick the legs off it, take the head off and...
I know, and lobsters and things. As you say, we'll happily eat them as a treat. But these... Oh, God. It's not done me any favours. And I felt so confident I was going to have the scorpion as well. Not now.
I love the scorpion.
Would you have the scorpion?
I love the scorpion.
Oh, my dear fellow. There you are.
Well, those fellas are really...
So you mean you're going to take
it
out?
Well, I've had those. The aftertaste of them is just horrendous. It is there for hours, but I'll have that.
Yep. You're going to eat it now in front of us?
Well, if I put it on in my mouth, it might...
Yeah.
I'll break it in half. And
that's a good idea.
Make it manageable.
Yeah.
Half the poison, half the fun.
How'd you do it?
God. Wow, that is one tough.
I think the scorpion might be alive. I think it might be like Han Solo.
Hey!
Well, not anymore, it's not.
Hey, tail end or front?
Well, I would go for the front. The tail end might have a sting in it or something.
Always ask a lady.
Yeah. Hey! Oh. James Carr.
Oh.
Well, you could hardly break the thing, so...
Come back in 9 hours.
Oh, you're having one too. Good for you. Excellent.
Well, I've been licking the brittle, and I thought I was going to be here all night. So I was eating like a club biscuit. So
scale the chocolate off.
Is it quite sweet in there? Is it sugar? It's basically sugar, isn't
it? It's horrible. The brittle.
Can't feel my toes.
Oh dear. It's like hemlock. It just works all the way up.
It's like bonfire night with death.
Go on, Sarah. You know you want to.
You've got to be joking.
Have a lick anyway.
That's what you had, the chocolate and
Sarah, the chocolate just think, the chocolate what if we all develop superpowers as a result of this?
Oh! I haven't had the ants.
How could you eat that?
You saw what it did to me.
He has the problem of nausea.
It's absolutely repellent.
It is, isn't it?
As soon as you break the chocolate, it whiffs.
I know, it's not nice.
Hang on. Something's happening. Something's happening.
Are scorpions known for forward rolls?
Oh, definitely.
Oh, yes, Sarah, showing your ignorance there. Very famous for their...
For what sort of business would you want to use a queer plunger?
I once had a nightmare with a plunger. So we had a New Year's Eve party and then the next day our toilet was blocked.
Mm.
And I thought, I'll nail this. I'd never used a plunger before.
Right.
Difficult to use.
Yeah, I thought I'd just whack it down there. Whacked it down and it suctioned just onto the bottom of the toilet. Brought it up. All I had was the piece of stick. And now I didn't just have to unblock the toilet. I had to get my hand in there to get the
OK, so queer plunger, what might you plunge into?
The ocean.
Water. You might plunge into water. It was a term given to con men who took advantage of the rules of the Society for the Recovery of Persons Apparently Drowned. So, set up in 1774, it's the two London doctors. They were worried that too many victims were being wrongly pronounced dead and sometimes buried alive. And so they developed new techniques of resuscitation. They offered a reward of 4 guineas, which is over £500 today. It was a lot of money, to anybody who successfully brought a drowned man back to life. Well, swindlers paired up with each other. So one would throw themselves into the river and pretend to drown, and the other would jump in and rescue him from the brink of death, and the two of them would then share the 4 guineas. And they became known as queer plungers. How many of you around the table know about W.C. Fields?
Yeah, the cricketer.
No.
That's W.G. Grace.
He was an amazing early 20th century actor and comedian. One of his very first jobs was to drown several times a day. So he worked at Atlantic City and he would pretend to swim out and then he would pretend to drown and somebody would come and rescue him and a great crowd would gather and they'd all applaud because he'd been saved and they were all so thrilled. And then they would buy beer and hot dogs and it was the beer and hot dog guys who paid W.C. Fields to drown several times a day. The Netherlands was the first country to have a society for resuscitation. Why the Netherlands?
People falling in canals.
Lots of water. Yes. Yeah. Sometimes it's just a really simple answer, isn't it?
They have fjords as well.
No. Don't have fjords there. Have you? God's sake.
No. You know, Netherlands is famously flat and fjords are famously steep.
Right.
So, no.
You know what? I'm just glad I didn't say it on national television.
No, that's a good thing.